Good evening. On behalf of the Indian Society of Gastroenterology, Tamil Nadu Chapter, I have great pleasure in meeting you for our monthly CME. Our patrons, Professor K.R.P. Sir, Professor Bala Sir, senior teachers, Professor Ahmadali Sir, Professor Raghuram Sir, other teachers, students, and members of the ASD. Today we have an interesting session. The presentations from MMC, New York Hospitals, SIMS, and Global Hospitals in various aspects, and followed by a trialogue. A trialogue, complete the dictionary defines as a discussion between among three people or three groups of people. So, we expect a dialogue, find everything, and we have good speakers. Endoscopist by Dr. Sudipto Chaudhary and radiologist Dr. Ravi Kumar and surgeon Dr. Cheswan. Over to our secretary to conduct the proceedings.
So, good evening. I got all the chairpersons for the first session, Dr. S. Jeevan Kumar, Dr. Shanti Vijay Ravan, Dr. Arun Prakash and Ram Kumar to come over the dais and conduct the proceedings.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to be with you this Saturday evening. First, we'll go to Dr. Ishwar, MMC, Chennai. He'll be presenting a case of hepatosplenomegaly.
So we started evaluation. This is the progress of all the routine investigations. Progressively, in our hospital, patient is progressed to the acute liver failure, and serum LDH is progressively raised, and patient is developed coagulopathy also. Other investigations were in peripheral smear, normocytic, normochromic anemia, severe thrombocytopenia is there, reticulocyte 2.8%, serum ferritin is normal, serum calcium is also normal, myontax serum ceruloplasmin, these things are normal, only ANA is 1:80, that is 2+ positive, non-specific nuclear pattern is there. Other autoimmune hepatitis markers are negative. Trophic infection screening panel negative for the patient, and serum IgA titer is 456, that is 2 times above the normal limit. And other leishmaniasis, rectal biopsy for amyloidosis, everything is negative. So patient is previously also underwent bone marrow biopsy. These reports I just quoted here. In 2018 September, erythroid hyperplasia consistent with hypersplenism. In December 18, erythroid hyperplasia, lymphocytes 20%, plasma cells 1%, no atypical cells, no storage evidence of storage disorders. Bone marrow aspiration in our hospital we did again. This is suggestive of hypercellular marrow, erythroid hyperplasia, lymphocytes were 15%. Plasma cells 2%, 2% of atypical cells with normal maturation. No evidence of LD bodies, flow cytometry, no evidence of malignant cells. Radiological wise, USG abdomen suggestive of liver is 22 cm, normal echo. Spleen is 28 cm with normal echo structure. No free fluid, no lymphadenopathy. PV Doppler wise, there is a dilated splenic vein and main portal vein, but flow, velocity, and phagic variations are normal. On CCT also suggestive of splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, dilated portal veins. There is no other significant findings. This is CT scan of the patient. Endoscopy, we did the endoscopy that suggestive of extraneous infraction along the greater curvature of the fundus and body, stomach compressed anteroposteriorly, no esophageal or fundal varices or portal hypertensive signs. Colonoscopy was normal. We took the rectal biopsy to rule out amyloidosis. After these things, we rule out NCPA because patient is fitting, but patient is worsening his condition, acute liver failure. Infiltrative disorders by diagnosis, we ruled out. Metabolic storage disorders also, we ruled out. We now left with only the two diagnoses, that is tropical splenomegaly and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. They are actually, one is here, one diagnosis treatable. If it is not treated, it is a fatal. Another one is treatable, semi-treatable, or untreatable also. This is very fatal also. This is, we took, for this patient, we need basically the first treatment was splenectomy because patient is having pancytopenia, thrombocytopenia, clerical disorders. So needed splenectomy for the treatment purpose and also diagnostic purpose. We took the SGE opinion for that. But SGE people, they told that you are considering lymphoma, also this is malaria, tropical splenomegaly. So they are not going for that. You just first definitive diagnosis should be there before going. They told that you can take PET CT scan. Hematological opinion, they told that they kept the possibility of malignancy, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma is the first. So they told that PET CT before, it can give some evidence before biopsy. Intervention radiologist, they are avoided because patient is having severe thrombocytopenia. They don't want to do biopsy in this patient. So we took the call that we just go ahead with PET CT scan. Here is the PET CT of the patient. Actually, on as a picture wise, there is no any such abnormality. There is no high uptake of FDG. This is the report, both showing demonstrating hepatosplenomegaly with normal FDG activity in liver, spleen, and bone marrow. In axial view also, it is suggestive of hepatosplenomegaly with normal FDG activity. Then this is also inconclusive, completely our ways off. Now we have to be open the main door by doing the biopsy. Whatever the illness it comes along this, we have to be accept it. And we explain the patient, we requested the radiologist, we go ahead with liver biopsy. So this is actually what I told now. This is saying that to be or not to be in this patient, liver biopsy, is it a diagnostic or not? So this is a histopathology report. In one view, we are seeing that this sinusoids are completely studded with lymphocytes, that is mononuclear cells. In magnified view also, this is the same. And actually, according whatever we kept the diagnosis, now after histopathology also same. In tropical splenomegaly also having same picture, and HTCL we are considering, that is also having similar picture. So it is also some extent conclusive, they want to rule out lymphoma still. We went ahead with, we just waited for 3 more days to immunohistochemistry, that is conclusively told that CD2, CD3, CD4, CD7 and CD56 positive with Ki-67 is increased, and that is suggestive of hepatosplenic T-cell lymphoma. After this, our questions are not yet complete because we just searched review of literature that is suggestive of tropical splenomegaly is a pre-malignant condition, even though it is inconclusive, many reported cases are there. So we start searching what is the relation between HTCL and tropical splenomegaly. Total 3, here PET CT is normal, 5. Why not it is a HMS? And next, what is the relation between HMS and HTCL? This is a case report and reviewed in HTCL patients of PET CT reports. They suggest you 1/3 of the 30% of the patients shows normal PET CT in primary hepatosplenic T cell lymphoma. Why not it is HMS? Yes, it is also possible. We are not completely routing this diagnosis. It is might be the previously C is HMS, now C might have developed and HTCL over that. Malaria endemic reason, we are coming under that, more common in young age, females, hepatic sinusoidal lymphocytosis is present in HMS, histopathology shows that, lymphadenopathy is absent, patients is presented with fever or non-fever. Now our patient is completely not having any fever symptoms. Actually that is taking away from the diagnosis because in B symptoms are not there. In non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, T-cell lymphoma, usually it presents as fever, B symptoms, but it is not there. HMS is debatable pre-malignant condition. HMS can undergo clonal evolution in splenic lymphoma, but it is unclear. It is not conclusive. HMS is associated with lower absolute lymphocyte count than lymphoproliferative disorders. This is also fitting. According to this is major and minor criteria. This is gross splenomegaly 10 cm, more below the costal margins of the adult. It will be there. It is diagnosis of exclusion. Elevated serum IgM level more than 2 standards. Clinical immunological response to antimalarial therapy will be there in tropical splenomegaly. Regression splenomegaly by 40% by 6 months of starting therapy. High antibody level, plasmodium species 1:800. Minor criteria were hepatic sinusoidal lymphocytosis, normal cellular and humoral response to antigenic challenge, hypersplenism, lymphocytic proliferation, familial occurrence. Our patient is completely satisfied all the diagnostic criteria. All the means, they told that more than two major or one major or three minor or it is one major or any of all of five. But anyhow, our patient is fitting into the tropical splenomegaly. This is suggestive of relation between tropical splenomegaly. The development of lymphoma also appeared to be a significant risk in HMS patients. Unfortunately, it might be impossible to distinguish HMS from splenic lymphoma, standard clinical and hematological technique. This is their report. These lines are taken from this article. This is from Tropical Medicine Journal. This is other articles that suggest you of this is a HMS is a pre-malignant condition. And also this, how they explained it as a pre-malignant is chronic antigenic stimulation is associated with expansion of T cells. It occurs in patients with long-term immunosuppressive therapy, falciparum malaria, autoimmune disorders like rheumatoid arthritis, celiac flu, poliomyelitis, multiple sclerosis patients. Means HMSs act as pre-malignant condition for development of HTLC. But these are just a case report. Now come to the what is the difference between HMS and HTLC. HMS is occurs in endemic countries in first and second decades, most commonly in females, lower absolute lower count in lower TLC count. It is exaggerated immune response to recurrent or persistent malarial infection, defective immune regulatory mechanism that causes over B cell proliferation and production of polyclonal non-specific gamma globulins. These are all associated with immunodeficiency, pregnancy. Patient is also having abortion 6 months before. These are all predisposing factors. Mortality is 85% in untreated patients, but it comes down to the 4 to 5% when we effectively treated HMS and good prognosis if treated well. HTLC is a rare and sporadic third and fourth decade of life, most commonly in males. Raised absolute eosinophil count will be there, lymphocyte count will be there. It is unknown etiology, controlled, it is an uncontrolled monoclonal proliferation of T cells. Cytogenetic mutations is a hallmark of the disease. Previous history of chronic immunosuppression will be there, like immunotherapy. We all know HTLC is happen in immunosuppressed patients, but that is also not so much useful because only 30% of the patients having the history of immunosuppression in HTLC. Most majority of the patient not having any history of HTLC in such patients, any history of immunosuppression. Discussion, this is HTLC is described as described and it is accepted in 2001 WHO classification of lymphomas. It is a very rare entity with peculiar clinical presentation. Total 250 reported cases are there. These are just reported cases. And in a review of 238 cases of HTLC, 72% were de novo. There is no identifiable risk factor for those patients. 18% developed in immunocompromised patients, 10% patients with inflammatory bowel disease. That is concerned with us. 10% of the patients, because we are most of the time we use biologicals. Sub classified into alpha, beta type, and gamma delta type. Gamma delta type is most common. Gamma delta is most commonly reported. Diagnosis should be considered in a patient presenting with fever, unexplained hepatosplenomegaly without lymph node enlargement. Lymph node enlargement is there that suggests other diagnosis, other non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. And abnormal LFT is present in 50% of the cases, mild elevated AST, ALT, alkaline phosphatase. Serum LDH is most of the time it is more than 3000. Pancytopenia observed in 75%, thrombocytopenia correlate with disease progression. Bone marrow involvement is a common at a diagnosis. Circulating neoplastic lymphocytes are present in peripheral blood 50 to 80% of the cases, because in our case, flow cytometry is completely normal. That's also suggests that flow cytometry not completely rule out the HTCL. Isochromosome arm is the hallmark of the disease. Now question is that FISH study is needed. We don't know because poor prognosis. It doesn't helps in prognostication also and further treatment also. Subtyping of HTLC, most of the time is gamma delta type. It is also grave prognosis, no necessary, it is best academic purpose. Now third question is, we have to treat HMS.
You are exceeding your time limit.
1 minute, sir. HMS treatment or not? This is question. This is a management. Many therapies are there, but HTCL is there is no the effective therapies till now established. Whatever chemotherapy is given is they are trial basis. There is no better over another treatment management. This is management of HIV. Main management is we have to eradicate the parasitemia of the malaria. In endemic regions, we have to be treat long term. Most of the time, it is a lifelong therapy. Many studies they are treated like that. Usually, we have to be treated with proconil, chloroquine, and proconil. If it is drug resistant region, we have to be treated with combination therapy like atovaquin, proconil, artemether, and lumefantrine combination therapy. Thank you.
Not be autoimmune hepatitis, can be a sequential presentation of SLE or any other autoimmune?
Profiles of autoimmune like SLE, like that, we are ruled out. But
because this patient has been having multiple, she has been having a lot of sequential symptoms. It can still, can it fit into SLE?
Ma'am, we just previously thought that is a possibility. Infiltrative disorders like connective tissue disorders, also autoimmune disorders we considered. We, whatever the profiles are available, we went through and took the rheumatology opinion. But these are, whatever the ANA positivity, they told that there is non-specific and inconclusive to get a diagnosis of autoimmune disorder.
And initially, tropical splenomegaly, there was heptomegaly also. Why would you consider in heptosplenomegaly?
No, ma'am, it is tropical splenomegaly. There is a splenomegaly also, hepatomegaly also, that is simultaneously.
How large is the liver?
Ma'am, it is 24 centimeter total and 9 centimeter below the cost margin. In tropical splenomegaly, hepatomegaly is also very massive, ma'am. It is almost equal the size of splenomegaly. It is basically tropical splenomegaly is a lymphoproliferative disorder that affects liver, spleen, and bone marrow.
And
both.
You said like you considered splenectomy for the coagulation. How can you correct coagulation?
No, ma'am, not coagulation. I am just pancytopenia. Patient is having thrombocytopenia. That's why only we want to do therapeutic.
Okay, yes. I thought you said both.
No, ma'am, actually, I'm not. Sir, actually, most of the patients in tropical splenomegaly, malarial antigen is negative. Only now, whatever recent studies are came, they suggest that PCR malaria we have to be do, and it might be positive also, it might be negative also. Previously, it is considered that even though it is. Haan, sir, IgM sir, polyclonal IgM titer is raised, and patient is also having definitive evidence of malaria. Previously, she is treated. We don't know exactly how he's treated. Actually, they told, sir, but IgM is elevated, but there is no other diagnosis we found. So we are just taking presumptively thinking in that. Sir, underwent whatever the reported cases of splenomegaly, they told that we can take both spleen or hepat, both biopsies. To here we took the hepatic biopsy because it is most of the time if liver pathology also we can get in this patient. Sir, bone marrow biopsy is completely inconclusive. That is suggestive of only hyperplastic changes.
Why was the 24-hour copper elevated more than 100?
Sir, actually in any, that is actually borderlinely raised.
No,
in
no.
Any patients 40. Of any liver pathology, it is borderlinely might be raised, that all.
Normal is 40.
Haan, sir,
anything above 100, we go in favor of one criteria.
We thought that, sir, and but biopsy also inconclusive, and nothing. We did CT and PET CT scan. That all suggestive of benign etiology itself.
Okay, finally, what is your diagnosis? This one?
Sir, this patient is HTLC, primary hepatic T-cell lymphoma, that is associated with tropical splenomegaly, that is SSM, that act as a pre-malignant condition that might have induced HTCL in the patient. Sir, actually, unfortunately, we are the oncologist, medical oncology people take over. They want to give the treatment. They prognosticated the patient. Due to the grave prognosis, patient is absconded. And we are also wanted to do some experiment because in this patient might helpful treating the HMS as HMS might be helpful. But actually, unfortunately, patient is lost. If it treated by HMS, then might be very good prognosis. We can expect some amount of life, gain in life, some.
May I ask you, where did you get the definition of tropical splenomegaly?
What?
Because Basu, decades and decades ago, had suggested tropical splenomegaly, big spleen syndrome. This has been going around not only in India, but also in Vietnam, etc., etc. And at that time, nobody thought of a liver becoming as big as the spleen in tropical splenomegaly. If you have an histological diagnosis of liver, leave that as such.
Oh.
Do not call this a tropical splenomegaly. Second point is, even in earlier times, when progranulin became available, there had been any number of reports where just long-term progranulin therapy had shrunk the spleen to some extent.
Awesome.
So, indirectly suggesting there possibly was a malarial etiology. But nobody till today has proven what comes under tropical splenomegaly is a definitely malarial in origin, most probably not. Secondly, liver as big as spleen is not acceptable in tropical splenomegaly.
No, sir, that is right, but both will be there, hepatosplenomegaly, but spleen
both
is...
You have liver, you have spleen, son, it will be there. I'm not saying no.
Oh.
I'm not saying no. But you said the liver is as big as the spleen. That's that's not acceptable in tropical splenomegaly.
Sir, that's why only I kept the query. HMS is query. We are presuming it is HMS. And it acted as a... But definitive diagnosis is HDCL. That is, definitive evidence is there. But only we are presuming... It's a HMS might be there.
Okay. Doctor, thank you very much. It was a very interesting case. And sir, thank you for the final roundup of that, Dr. Krishnan. It was
thank you.
And the next presenter for the day would be Dr. Ravi Kiran from Meerut Hospital's gastropathy, a rare case.
Doctor, your time is 15. Doctor, your time is 15 minutes.
Yes, sir. Good evening, one and all. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers as well as my teachers for giving me this opportunity for presenting this case. Today, I'm going to present a rare case of gastropathy. This 52-year-old gentleman, he has come with complaints of diarrhea, which was semi-solid, in 2 to 3 times per day, which was non-foul smelling, and there's no blood, mucus, or oil, and it was variable quantity. It was not related to food, and no nocturnal symptoms since 2.5 months. Otherwise, he was not having any other symptoms. Coming to the past history, he was diagnosed as hypertensive 6 months back, and he was started on bisoprolol. Personal history, he consumes alcohol once a week for the past 20 years and smokes around 1 pack per day for the past 15 years. Otherwise, family and drug history is negative. Clinical examination, he was apparently well with unremarkable general and systemic examination. We proceeded with the basic laboratory evaluation, which showed a normal complete blood count with differentials, with normal differentials, normal ESR, peripheral smear, and his liver functions, renal functions, urine routine, urine analysis, and stool analysis were normal. Thyroid profile was normal, and ultrasound abdomen showed fatty liver, and echo was normal. So with this, we proceeded with the endoscopy, which are prominent gastric folds, which were persistent even in the antrum, and the mucosa was edematous and thickened, and with mild difficulty, we could enter the duodenum, proximal duodenum, where it was thickened and showed a small ulcer, tiny ulcer in the duodenum. So we took a biopsy from the antrum, pyloric wall, pyloric ring, and proximal duodenum, as well as the D2 for evaluation of diarrhea, and we have also taken the biopsies from the antrum. The colonoscopy, we did a colonoscopy which showed a deformed cecum and ileocecal wall with prolapsing ileum. This was the prolapsing ileum, and we took a biopsy from then also, which showed a small whitish lesions which can be appreciated here throughout the right colon, while the rest of the colon was normal. So we concluded, we came to the provisional diagnosis of thickened gastric folds, which is either gastritis or gastropathy, queric cause. The differentials we considered were infectious gastritis, Zollinger-Ellison syndrome, lymphocytic gastritis, granulomatous, or reactive versus hyperplastic gastropathy, or malignancy like lymphoma or adenocarcinoma. The histopathology revealed ulceration of foveal epithelium with edematous lamina propria and few extravasated RBCs and mild chronic inflammation. There was no evidence of any H. pylori or dysplasia. Rest of the biopsies were insignificant, while the colon biopsy showed features of chronic colitis. We proceeded with the CECT abdomen, which showed, these are the images of the CECT abdomen, which showed thickened gastric, especially in the thickened wall of the stomach, especially in the distal body, as well as the antrum and pyloric region and proximal duodenum. This is the video of the CECT abdomen. Sorry, I think it's playing. Mistake is there. It's playing. I'm sorry. The video is playing upside down. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. The CT showing a thickened gastric wall, especially in the distal body and the proximal duodenum. The imaging report showed a diffuse wall thickening of the stomach and first part of the duodenum, predominantly involving antrum, with a thickness of around 12 millimeter and a small duodenal ulcer. The other feature were colonic diverticulosis with features of mild colitis. With this, we proceeded with additional testing with gastrin levels, which were normal, and fecal calprotectin was normal. CMV PCR was negative, and suspecting celiac, we took a TTG IgA, which was negative, and the CEA and CA99 were normal. Because H. pylori is very common, also we went through the literature, they suggested the treatment with H. pylori. So we went ahead with empirical therapy with H. pylori kit for 2 weeks. And then afterwards, we planned for a EUS for the thickened gastric folds. And prior to that, we just wanted to have a relook gastroscopy. When we did that, it showed the persistence of gastric folds in the antrum, as well as still the pyloric antropyloric region is thickened with edematous mucosa and were persisting in the proximal duodenum as well. Then we attempted a biopsy in the thickened pyloroduodenal ring, and we took the first bite. Then again we attempted a bite-on-bite biopsy, which led to the development of this huge ulcer-like crater, which we couldn't explain. And we were also a little worried because of the visible, probable underlying muscle fibers as well. So it's more appreciated here in this video. Since it was very huge, we deferred the further plan of EUS biopsy and also the full thickness biopsy, as this itself was deep enough. The histopathology of antral biopsy revealed a florid hyperplasia of foveolar epithelium with edematous lamina propria and foci of homeosteocytes with infiltrate of lymphoplasmacytes and plasma and lymphocytes and plasma cells. The H. pylori stain was again negative, and rest of the biopsies were normal. They have reported as consistent with Mentrier's disease. So with ruling out other causes, the CMV H. pylori were negative, although CMV gastritis is more common in children, but still we wanted to rule out. It's uncommon, but still can be possible in adults. So we did that. We ruled out infectious gastritis with that. The gastrin levels were normal, and the normal parietal cells ruled out Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. And there was no intraepithelial lymphocytes in the presence of diffuse foveolar hyperplasia instead of patchy distribution rules out lymphocytic gastritis. And there no absence of granulomas, again ruled out granulomatous gastritis. And the oxyntus cells were normal, so ruling out hypersecretory gastritis. And there were no abundance of parietal cell mass, so the PPI effect has been ruled out. And there were no lymph nodes in CT, nor any monoclonal lymphocytes in the biopsy. So that rules out lymphoma or malignancy. So we came to the final diagnosis of Menetrier's disease. Menetrier's disease was first reported by a French pathologist, Pierre Eugène Menetrier, in the year 1888, where he studied and in the pathology specimens, cadaver pathology specimens. So hyperplastic gastropathy is a rare condition characterized by giant gastric folds associated with epithelial hyperplasia. Two clinical syndromes have been associated, mainly Menetrier's disease and its variant, the hyperplastic hypersecretory gastropathy, the other being the Zollinger-Ellison syndrome. This is the paper by Olmsted in 1976, which showed that initially Menetrier's disease was a disease of the stomach corpus, but antral sparing. But this paper, he has studied 13 cases which showed that antrum can also be involved, and it is not as uncommon as previously described. And he has showed that antrum involvement has almost 46% of those patients had antrum involvement. In that, only antrum, isolated antrum involvement had 8% of the cases. So Menetrier's disease is basically protein-losing gastropathy, but it need not always be there, and is associated with hypochloridia. The etiology is unknown, but overactivity of transforming growth factor with epithelial growth factor receptor overactivity leading to gastropathy, and infections with H. pylori as well as CMV has been attributed. It is more common in males in the age group of 30 to 60 years, but average age of 55 years. It usually presents with epigastric pain, nausea, diarrhea, weight loss, pedal edema, and hypoalbuminemia. Although the risk of gastric acid is increased, but the definitive risk could not be assessed because of the rarity of the disease. The diagnosis is usually by upper GI endoscopy and a biopsy, especially a full thickness mucosal biopsy. And the typical findings include foveolar hyperplasia with cystic dilatation, and parietal cell and chief cells may be decreased and replaced by mucous glands. The treatment includes anti-H. pylori therapy and CMV therapy, especially in cases those associated with CMV gastritis, and anti-secretory agents like proton pump inhibitors and anti-histamine antagonists. A monoclonal antibody against EGFR receptor, epithelial growth factor receptor, has been tried, which is cetuximab. And in some patients have responded to cetuximab, and some have responded to octreotide. This is a slide showing the approach to a thickened gastric folds. So whenever there's a CT showing, CT or barium series showing a gastric wall thickness more than 10 millimeter, or endoscopy not flattening, endoscopic, even with air insufflation, the gastric folds not flattening, and EUS evaluation showing more than the thickness more than 4 millimeters, considered thickened gastric folds. So with the background history and then tissue sampling, either with a pinch biopsy or macro biopsy or jumbo biopsy, and EUS wall thickness, as well as assessing whether the superficial or deep layers are involved, and other signs like lymph nodes, and other laboratory investigations to confirm for H. pylori, CMV, as well as fasting gastrin levels and serum proteins and fractions. And also in Menetrier's disease, gastric pH is high because of the low gastric output and hypochloridia. And with that, Menetrier's disease can be diagnosed with characteristic features of foveolar hyperplasia and decreased parietal cells, while preserved glandular architecture and tortuous glands. And another close differential diagnosis being polyposis syndrome, but usually they are patchy edematous wall, which again can be diagnosed with biopsy. And malignancy, EUS features of malignancy should be there, and presence of malignant cells on the biopsy concludes malignancy. So aim of presentation being the rarity of Menetrier's disease, first of all. In that antral involvement of Menetrier's disease is another rarity, and to revise the approach to thicken gastric folds. Thank you.
Sir, 1 minute. Sir, this case, I just want to ask the audience now, how common we are seeing, how many of us have seen thickened gastric folds? And then this is a purely a histological diagnosis. What they are saying, we have to listen to it. What we have done is we could have ruled out all other causes, but whether it is really Menetrier's disease, we do not know. And when we review the literature, they say that it's 1 in 2 million it happens. This is the first time we are encountering this. And second thing, the worrying aspect is all the literature says that fundus and body is predominantly involved, though there is a rarity in the literature which says that antrum also may be involved. And third one is, Menetrier's disease, they say that there may be occult malignancy or it may turn malignant later. So how common we are going to keep him under follow-up? And what is it we are going to tell to the patient? And the clinical presentation also was a rarity. Here, what all we have read is always they have a protein-losing enteropathy. But the incidence of all these individual findings are only to the tune of 60 to 65%. So this patient who presented with only with diarrhea, who has recovered now, and he has gone with the diagnosis of Menetrier's disease, which still we have doubts that whether we are correct in what we have attributed and what to do for him. So that is what we want to take the audience opinion also. No, actually, we empirically we treated him with H. pylori as we has predicted, as we has presented for 2 weeks, and then we called him back for a repeat endoscopy. As in a gap of 2 weeks, we did the repeat endoscopy with an idea of EUS and possibly strip biopsy also, injecting and then to elevate and do it. But and another thing what I want to ask is, unfortunately, after taking a bite-on-bite biopsy, and that was a very concerning outcome after taking the biopsy. I hope everybody will agree on that. After taking just 2 bites. Yeah, that's what, and he was due to fly to US within next 2 days for a business trip of 4 weeks there. So we took a biopsy and it was quite alarming for me. In fact, we admitted him, we had to hold him for a day to whether there was any inadvertent eventualities. Does it happen like this? That's what another thing what I want to ask. And this was almost like a deep biopsy with a almost like an ESD, and the muscle layer is clearly seen there.
That was not to present in the second.
That was only for the amount.
He had a duodenal ulcer. Yeah. He was already on PPIs. Why? How do you explain the presence of duodenal ulcer? H. pylori is negative.
No, not on. Previously, not on ulcers. This is the first time he's presenting.
And he was on PPIs.
He was on H. pylori.
Sir, the first gastroscopy when he done, he was not on any drugs, sir.
History, you said patient was.
Not on NSAIDs. Not on NSAIDs or not on PPIs, sir. Not on any.
No, on index presentation, he was not on any medication.
I see a radiologist here. Please come and know that. Menetrier disease, the first you suspect is barium. And I have seen that.
No, sir, hypertrophic gastric folds only we can predict, sir. Barium will say that the folds are thickened.
They will be able to tell you if it's.
No, we can't say whether it's Menetrier's.
You have not done.
No, sir. Menetrier is a differential diagnosis for hypertrophic gastric folds.
No,
hypertrophic gastric folds itself has a differential diagnosis, sir. And that is what he has predicted, sir. Just can run the.
You have not done barium meal, you can't say it won't.
No. What we are going to
My do suggestion, submission is that in a situation like this, instead of repeating the scopy, I would have done a barium. That would have given a fairly clinical characteristic picture, which I still remember from my memory, is kept in the Radiology Museum of PJ Chandigarh.
No, sir. What a barium can say is, it can say all that, what it can say is, it can say that the gastric folds are thickened. But what underlying pathology is causing the problem, only an histology can tell us. Whether it's in pediatrics, the same thickened fold may be because of CMV related, where we have to treat him with ganciclovir. Whereas in adult, CMV is very rare, and it could be of all these causes, as Zollinger listened. And then lymphocytic, where an intraepithelial lymphocytes will be there. So I believe that only. No, it's agreed, madam, but how common?
No, not the question of being common or not. When this DD came in, I just told him Menetrier's.
Oh, okay, that's fine. Yeah, that's okay.
Yeah, so the that differential should have included of
that.
Differential.
No, that is agreed, madam.
Differential Menetrier's should
have
come in.
Yeah, that is agreed. I think we have missed it.
Because it was antral predominant, we didn't initially think of that.
No, antral
person.
Predominant, one thing folds are thickened. I think that's why I just told him Menetrier's. I just informed him Menetrier's.
No, that should have been included.
And I thought purposefully it was not mentioned. Purposefully it was not mentioned.
No, it was unintentional. It was incidental.
No, one more thing, one doubt here.
We know when there's only hypertrophic gastric mucosal folds. In the CT scan, it's a submucosal that is markedly thickened. It looks almost lineitis like thickening is there. That has to be explained.
Yeah, that's agreed, sir. We went through the CT literature also. But what the CT says is,
such a thickness.
If there is a there is a delineation of the layers in CT. Or I'll put the other ways. If there's an absence of delineation of the layers in CT, it goes more towards a malignant pathology. But here, there was a good enhancement of the mucosa. And then there was a mild thickening in the muscle layer.
And, you had
and then serous also well seen.
And you had difficulty in negotiating the pylorus.
Yeah, there was mild difficulties. So that is what the doubt, what I want to raise it, sir. Whether we are missing any malignancy, no, but how far we have to go? Should we go for a lab assisted full thickness biopsy?
Still keep an open mind of malignancy.
Follow.
Do we have a histopathology slide here?
No, sir. Actually, we couldn't get it.
It looks like a soft, features in histopathology. So there may be some differentials. We have to probably discuss with the pathologist. Because this foveolar hyperplasia and cystic, I don't think we saw cystic dilatation there.
In the slide, they have not reported itself, but when we discussed with, then they told that there's a gross prominent foveolar hyperplasia with dilatation of the glands, but not corkscrew pattern, but there is dilatation of the glands there. So he said this most likely possibility of meningitis disease.
Actually, meningitis came into different areas only because of the pathologist.
Pathologies.
Otherwise, we were taught of presenting it as only as hypertrophic gastric folds, and we want to take an opinion that how common people have seen and what was the diagnosis they have encountered or what to do with this kind of situation.
Right, sir.
Okay.
Conventional apogee endoscopic biopsy, the same site you repeat and you show as something like an ulcer. What are the conditions where you get a submucosal biopsy producing such a lesion? Is
such
there
a,
any
such a defect,
being an endoscopy?
Such a defect. No,
yes.
So that's what I want to ask everybody, sir, because it was alarming for me.
No answer is coming from the audience. So
no,
you have
I am ashamed
gone
to tell
to the
that it was a bit difficult for me to ask a patient to get admitted after a biopsy. Because this patient was due to fly to US within 48 hours. So I had to take all the care that he doesn't land in any eventuality. I don't know, sir. I want to ask whether it was because of gross inflammation it happened.
Well, have you come across? Well,
I mean, Sudipta, I think whether any lead from you. Now, how come you encountered post biopsy such a crater? Simple biopsy.
Usually not. It's not a very common finding. I'm not sure whether.
No, it's not a common means.
But I'm saying that we usually don't do much of bite on bite anymore. Biopsies. I'm not very sure. Even when we did it, even for those situations when we had GISTs to do a bite on bite or a tunnel biopsies, we never encounter such a defect.
No, honestly, I'll tell you, it was not an intentional bite on bite. But
okay.
It, somewhere I took it, went deep on deep. No, you said that you do that. But in such situations, what is that you are depending on?
We would rather do an EUS here.
No, agreed, but. Okay.
That
no,
would
because
actually
being a
help
mucosal
us,
lesion,
that would
no, no.
actually help
so
us.
So what I felt is,
sir,
if being a mucosal lesion, I would rather go for US, but prior to that, I'll go for mucosal biopsy also.
Yes, sir. That agreed, sir. But if I would maybe
but
do one
do
biopsy.
But do you do a strip biopsy?
Sir,
do you do a strip biopsy?
No.
Sir,
no,
we are running out of time.
Okay. Okay.
No, sir. That's what we.
Sir, thank you, sir. We are running out of time. Thank you, Dr. Ravi Kiran, for presenting that rare case. We'll go to the third case. It's by Dr. Rohan from SIMS, Chennai, a case of impacted basket.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Rohan from SIMS Hospital, Chennai. So after two intense clinical discussions, my case would be more of a technical aspect. So this is some scenario which I believe is quite often encountered, if not often, but yes, surely encountered, an impacted Dormia basket while extracting a CBD stone. So I would not focus too much on the case, but more on what the solution for the case was. So as we know, problems occur during procedures, and how to tackle with them is the next step. So coming to the case background, this is a 60-year-old gentleman who had presented 3 months prior to the current presentation with a history of right upper abdominal pain, fever, chills, and jaundice for 10 days. And he had systemic hypertension. Examination had revealed icterus and right upper quadrant tenderness. On investigations, the liver function tests were deranged with increased total bilirubin and increased alkaline phosphatase. The CT abdomen had showed multiple large space-occupying lesions in the liver, query liver abscesses, with a large CBD calculus with upstream common bile duct dilatation. The ERCP was done during that presentation, which showed a large, hard CBD calculus on the cholangiogram. It could not be crushed with a mechanical lithotripter, and a wide sphincterotomy was done, and a double pictal biliary plastic stent was inserted. And the patient was started on antibiotics and ursodeoxycholic acid and asked to follow up after 3 months for a repeat ERCP. So this is the current scenario. The patient has presented to us 3 months later. This time he does not have any fever or any abdominal pain. The liver function tests have returned to normal. So the plan was to repeat an ERCP procedure, remove the CBD stone if it is there, and remove the already inserted biliary plastic stent. And of course, then go ahead with the laparoscopic cholecystectomy. So this is the procedure we did. So we started with the ERCP. There was already a wide sphincterotomy seen. The plastic stent in situ was removed, and cholangiogram showed a large calculus at the distal end of the bile duct. Balloon trawling was attempted, but it was unsuccessful. So we inserted the Daumea basket, and it opened up, and the CBD stone was captured within the wires of the basket. So Daumea basket, I've just demonstrated a picture. It's basically has four stainless steel wires at 90 degrees arranged radially that open into a stone to allow capture. So we have the fluoroscopy images showing when it was cannulated, the bile duct, and the image on the right showing the opened up Daumea basket capturing the CBD stone. So the problem now, so this is where the this discussion begins. So during withdrawal, what happened was that the basket stone complex got snugly caught up in the distal common bile duct, very close to the ampulla. There was no movement possible, antigrade or retrograde. So this is how it looked on the endoscopy. So as we see in the image on the left side, the Daumea basket is caught up in the distal CBD, and we ultimately had to remove the duodenoscope. And in the image on the right, we can see that the basket has been caught up in the distal CBD without the scope in situ. So the standard troubleshooting protocol, whatever is available, we first analyze the situation, see the available things, assess the complications, and then go for the solutions. So as per standard, whatever we knew, we removed the plastic sheath of the basket handle. We used an alliance device to attach to the basket wires, and a crushing of the caught stone was attempted, which was unsuccessful. Then we replaced the alliance device with a mechanical lithotripter, the Sohendra lithotripter, and despite cranking of the wires, stone could not be crushed. Here I would want to mention that the bile duct had become so straightened, as we can see on the fluoroscope, that we thought that cranking too much might even cause perforation of the bile duct. So then we thought of balloon trawling or inserting a smaller size basket and basketing the impacted basket tip. So the issue here was cannulation was not possible due to the snugly fit complex at the distal end of the bile duct. So here we see the alliance device on the left side, and on the right side a picture of the patient where we used the Sohendra mechanical lithotripter for crushing the stone. So alternatives. So we thought of endoscopic sphincteroplasty or balloon dilatation of the ampulla. But again, it has issues, like there is a risk for perforation, bleeding. So what we had in hand was a basket stone complex with the proximal end of the wires protruding from the oral cavity. So what other endoscopic techniques can we think of? Well, we will come across them in the discussion. What one needs to assess is what can be readily available at that moment and which one in this particular case could be applied without cannulation into the bile duct, since that was not possible in this case. So as I showed you these previous fluoroscopy images with the dormia basket impacted in the distal bile duct. It could not be moved, pushed anteriorly or posteriorly, or retrograde or antegrade. So then we thought of laparoscopy. So a laparoscopic CBD exploration was the next thought. The issues here are, why is CBD exploration in laparoscopy, why is it considered such a difficult issue? There are certain issues like this edema, adhesions close to the bile duct. So identification of the common bile duct becomes an difficult part. So here what the surgeons do is they use an aspiration technique and they aspirate bile and thus identify the bile duct. So here the supraduodenal common bile duct was identified. Choledochotomy was done. And again, the issues was that the the basket stone complex was in the distal common bile duct and not in the mid CBD or the supraduodenal CBD. So we could not see anything despite the choledochotomy. And the laparoscopy instruments being too rigid, they cannot be pushed into the to enter the distal common bile duct. So here we see the laparoscopy images. As we see in the first panel, there are adhesions and edema surrounding the bile duct. After adhesiolysis, the bile duct was exposed, and by aspiration technique, it was identified. Then we thought of inserting a cholangioscope. And the cholangioscope did demonstrate a basket stone complex at the distal common bile duct. The issue being to do endotherapy with this is, it is too weak to disengage such a large complex. So what we then went ahead with was something different, a laparoendoscopic approach. We already had a 15 mm dilated common bile duct with a choledochotomy incision available. The adult gastroscope could be inserted through the umbilical laparoscopic port and guided into the distal common bile duct via laparoscopic guidance. The basket stone complex was identified. Then we tried inserting a balloon for extracting the impacted basket stone complex. But the issues was the balloon could not be passed beyond the complex because of the lack of space between the basket stone complex and the bile duct wall. Here, as we see in the images, this is a choledochotomy incision made in the supraduodenal common bile duct, and the gastroscope inserted with laparoscopic assistance into the distal common bile duct. So we went one step further. We thought of a therapeutic laparoendoscopy. We introduced alligator forceps through the working channel of the gastroscope. The stone, being very large and hard, it was nibbled. It required a lot of patience. The basket wires were disengaged from the stone by nibbling. The stone fragments were then extracted via the choledochotomy port, and the tip of the basket was caught, and basket withdrawal was attempted. So once the basket was out of the laparoscopy incision, the basket wires, here we analyzed that we anticipated a further mechanical trauma to the upper GI tract if had the entire length of the wires being pulled out retrograde via the laparoscopy port. So we thought we'll cut the basket wires as soon as it is out of it, out of the laparoscopy incision. And the remaining part, we ensured that a part was tip was still outside the oral cavity, and it was pulled out by the anesthetist. So here we see the basket being removed in the first panel, and in the second panel we can see the stone being extracted. So what we felt is we had to be double sure that the common bile duct was clear now. So we introduced the gastroscope again into the common bile duct, and we identified another hidden stone, the one which we can see on the right panel. And it was extracted with alligator forceps. A plastic Amsterdam stent, a straight stent, was deployed anti-grade, and the choledochotomy incision was closed without putting any T-tube or anything. And then we thought of doing a conventional endoscopy just to ensure no damage to the upper gastrointestinal tract, and whether the tip of the Amsterdam stent, sorry, there's a typo, protruded by the ampulla. And this was followed by a laparoscopic cholecystectomy procedure. So here we can see the stent in situ. So what does the literature say? Various complications of basket trawling have been reported while CBD stone extraction. So there can be a trapped basket surrounding a stone, fracture of the wires of the basket, or there can be fracture of the main or the central wire or the operating wire. There can be malfunction of the mechanical lithotripter crank handle, or there can be ductal injury. Now, impaction is a well-known complication with an incidence of 0.8 to 5.6%. What exactly is impaction? Impaction is basically inability to withdraw the basket with stone from the papillary orifice or separate the stone from the basket which is already inside the biliary channel lumen. What could be the risk factors or etiology for this impaction? How do we know that which cases are prone to have an impaction? So in this, what the literature says is when there is a discrepancy between the size of the stone and the CBD diameter, or when the stone is hard in consistency, when there is an inadequate sphincterotomy, or when the location of the stone is in the distal bile duct, and when there is an inability to manipulate the basket, antegrade or retrograde, or the presence of a periampillary diverticulum. These are all red signs which could pose a patient at a risk for basket impaction. So what could be the rescue approach? Till date, there have been multiple case series, case reports over the last three decades. There has been no fixed guideline or study yet to suggest superiority of one method or the other. So what determines the approach? So as we know, the device availability is one of the most essential things. Location of stone in the biliary tree is important, because in our case, since it was in the distal bile duct, just a plain laparoscopy could not extract the stone. Bleeding perforation risk should be analyzed or assessed. The space offered for additional instrumentation or cannulation is important. Otherwise, we could have also tried some other techniques which will be described, and of course the skill. So various techniques have been attempted in the past, and these are broadly classified as endoscopic techniques, surgical, and some other techniques. So endoscopic, the common one is mechanical lithotripsy, where one tries to crush the stone and then remove the basket. Then there is extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy with nasobiliary drain, because ESWL generally takes some time for the stones to crush. So it takes about 2 to 3 days till which the patient can be put on a nasobiliary drain. Then some other techniques are electrohydraulic lithotripsy. A second basket can be used to pull the tip of the impacted basket. Balloon trawling of the basket stone complex has been tried. Then some devices of late have a mechanism of releasing the tip of the basket once it is attached to a handle. And cholangioscopic laser, holmium laser lithotripsy has been tried. A temporary metallic stenting to dislodge the impacted complex has been tried. An extended sphincterotomy, or what they call it as the post-cut technique, has been tried. Endoscopic balloon ampullary dilatation, or endoscopic sphincteroplasty, is one of the methods. They've also attempted APC of the central wire of the basket, but again, there are risks in this also, because it can cause thermal injury to the common bile duct, which is in continuity with the basket stone complex, and some self-disengaging baskets are available. So surgical options, as we know, are open laparoscopic, and others are just spontaneous passage or a transhepatic cholecystoscopic lithotripsy. So this is an analysis. What we did is we went through all the papers which has been published since 1993, and there have been some 18 papers on this, and these have been single case reports or case series. What I tried to do is include some important factors like the number of cases, the technique used, the size of the stone, the location in the bile duct, and whether there was a periampillary diverticulum. This periampillary diverticulum, some say, is one of the risk factors for impaction, as reported by two of the studies, by Yilmaz and by Liu. So various techniques have been mentioned in this. And in all these, the stone size has been...
The time is over.
Yes, sir. Just last. Yes, sir. So difficulties in our case was an impacted basket, a large stone, distal impaction, failed mechanical lithotripsy, no space available for further cannulation and for other rescue techniques, and neither proximal or distal dislodgement was feasible. So why surgical? Because space and visualization is an advantage. Instrumentation is there, and there is lesser risk of bleeding or perforation. And cholecystectomy was anyways going to be the next step. Why laparoendoscopic in this case? Is because the complex was in the distal common bile duct, and cholecystoscope it could not dislodge the complex. Gastroscope, a green signal because it was flexible, it has better accessories, 10 mm port was already available, and there was an adequate cholecystectomy for this to happen. The take-home message would be, it's necessary to anticipate complications of basket extraction while CBD stone extraction. One should assess the risk factors for impaction. We should be aware of them. There's no fixed rescue approach. Of course, endoscopy would anywhere be preferable over laparoscopy to open, but the technique which we used, laparoendoscopic technique, would lie somewhere in between there. The availability is one of the important factors, and technical feasibility or space for further cannulation also determines the technique. Complications like bleeding, perforation should always be kept in mind. And of course, as we all know, necessity drives innovation. So thank you. It's all because of teamwork that this can be possible.
Any questions from the audience?
Yeah, I had one case, impaction of stone within the basket, and the surgeon came and removed it. I cut this thing and took the scope out. When I reviewed the literature at the time, Peter Cotton says, suspect a bit of a mucosa into the getting entangled into the basket, and that suspicion gets strengthened when you can't move it up or down. If only the size of the stone is the problem, then you should be able to move it up and down. And secondly, do not delay surgery. As a matter of fact, in his own words, don't let the surgeon go to sleep. Bring him and do it immediately.
Size 1.5.
You did not include that impaction of a little mucosa into the basket in all of the list. You didn't read about it, obviously, but that was the case I saw.
Okay. 15 mm was. Ideal. Yes.
Laparoscopic cholecystectomy with a cholecystectomy. I think that would have been ideal, or you anticipate problems with such a large stone.
Yes. Okay, the discrepancy between the diameter of the stone and the bile duct, that is what we thought. And there have been some case reports with larger stones also being extracted with endoscopic techniques.
If it is pigment type, it's fine, but this is more, it's quite hard, no?
Yes, ma'am.
So I think that anticipation would have been important.
Okay, doctor.
Any stone can be extracted by endoscopy method. Only thing is, you should anticipate what trouble you will have, and then you have to choose the method. If you have a duct size and lower duct size and stone discrepancy, I mean, you should adopt measures to counter that. Either, I mean, you cannot make the lower duct dilate to that level, but you can make the stone smaller. You go for a laser lithotripsy, ESWL can be done. So you should choose the method, but otherwise any stone can be extracted by.
Okay, doctor. When you go for a hunting, you should have all the equipments. But anyway, finally you won the battle. Thank you. And
thank you.
We'll go to the final case, Dr. Kavya from Global Hospital. Unusual and treatable cholestasis if identified early.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Kavya from the Department of Pediatrics, Gleneagles Global, Chennai. Today I'm going to present you a rare case of cholestasis that we have encountered. The child in question is a 9-month child who was referred to us in June 2019 for a liver transplant with a diagnosis of decompensated liver disease with a possible underlying metabolic etiology. Coming to the history of the child, she was the firstborn female child of parents who had a third degree consanguineous marriage. The mother had an uneventful pregnancy. The baby was delivered at term via normal vaginal delivery with a birth weight of 2.5 kgs. She had jaundice on day 4 of life, which was treated as physiological jaundice. However, at 2 months, she was noticed to have increasing jaundice with high-colored urine, which was staining the diapers, and a normal stool color. At this point of time, she was admitted to the government hospital, and a detailed evaluation was going on, and she was managed with supportive measures. The working diagnosis then was a progressive cholestasis of newborn. At 9 months of age, the child had deepening of the jaundice with edema, vomiting, and irritability. She was admitted to a private hospital here in Chennai with ascites and portal hypertension. She was started on supportive measures, and a detailed evaluation was done. The workup done showed conjugated hyperbilirubinemia with elevated transaminases, prolonged INR. The serum bile acids were within the normal limits. Urine succinyl acetone ruled out tyrosinemia. Tandem mass spectroscopy was normal. Torch and viral markers were negative. Thyroid profile was normal. Ultrasound abdomen ruled out biliary atresia, and the changes were suggestive of chronic liver disease. Apogee endoscopy showed prominent varices at the lower end of the esophagus. Exon sequencing was sent at this point of time. The report was still due. Unfortunately, the child presented to us on 13th of June with acute deterioration in the form of poor feeding, drowsiness, and hurried breathing. There was history of decreased urine output. However, there were no bleeding manifestations, and there was no seizure activity. Physical examination showed the height and weight of the child between the 10th and 25th centile. She was deeply ectric with edema with a GCS of 10. There were no bleeding manifestation. The child had splenohepatomegaly with moderate ascites. Investigations on admission showed anemia with a hemoglobin of 5.3, a normal total and platelet count, prolonged PT and INR. The liver function test showed conjugated hyperbilirubinemia with elevated liver enzymes and a normal GGT. Ammonia was also elevated, and the child presented with hypoglycemia. Electrolytes showed hypokalemia, which was attributed to the diuretics the child was on, and ABG showed no signs of acidosis. The child was admitted to PICU, hypoglycemia was corrected, and the dyselectrolyteemia was managed with appropriate fluids. She received PRBC, FFP, and cryoprecipitate transfusions for corrections. And during the course of stay, the peak ammonia was 230, and the peak INR was 4.42. On day 11 of admission, the child had further deterioration with bleeding manifestations and worsening encephalopathy, requiring elective ventilation. The following day, she went into shock, requiring multiple inotropic support, and had persisting bleeding manifestations in the form of melena and hematuria. Blood culture then grew Streptococcus pneumonia species, and the sensitive antibiotics were started. She responded well to this, and repeat cultures turned sterile. She was reviewed by the transplant surgical team at this point of time, and in view of progressive deterioration of the liver function with coagulopathy, she was planned for a liver transplant as priority. Coming to the details of the transplant, the child underwent a live donor liver transplant on 1st of July. The mother was the donor, and the left lateral segment was used. There was no blood group mismatch. Both the mother and the child were O positive, and the graft to recipient weight ratio was 3.7. The explant liver grossly was shrunken with a nodular surface, and histopathology showed diffuse severe hepatocellular cholestasis with portal fibrosis. Coming to the course of post-transplant, the child was off inotropic support by the first post-operative day, and she was extubated by the third post-operative day. Even in the post-operative period, she had melena with a fall in the hemoglobin requiring multiple PRBC transfusion. However, it had settled by the sixth post-operative day, and she was maintaining stable hemoglobin. Dopplers and labs done serially were within the normal limits, which was indicating a good graft function. Immunosuppression of the child was in the form of IV corticosteroids initially, which were gradually made into oral, and oral tacrolimus. Anticoagulation was in the form of low molecular weight heparins, which was then changed to aspirin. The child was finally discharged on the 17th post-operative day after a cumulative hospital stay of 35 days. The clinical exome sequencing report, which was sent initially, the report was ready only when the child was in the post-transplant recovery period, and it showed a mutation in the CYP7B1 gene, which causes congenital bile acid synthesis defect type 3. This is the sixth reported case in the world, and the third reported case in the world with a successful liver transplant, and also the first reported case from India, which also had a successful liver transplant. Presently, the child is doing well with good weight gain and normal liver functions. Here we have explained in detail, collected the data of all the cases which have been reported so far. The index case was first reported in the year 1998 by Sechel et al. Since then, over the last 20 years, only 5 other cases, including ours, has been reported. As we can see, there is no racial or sex predilection. All of the cases presented in the newborn or infancy period with conjugated hyperbilirubinemia and a normal GGT level. Tandem mass spectroscopy or GCMS with a genetic analysis remained the main modes of diagnosis for this particular defect. And coming to the management, out of all the cases, the case reported by Dai et al. In the year 2014 was the only child who recovered with oral supplementation of bile acids. All the other cases had liver disease which was severe enough to warrant a liver transplant. And in the last 10 years, all the children who underwent a liver transplant had good survival. Now I would like to throw some light on the congenital bile acid synthesis defects. As we all know, the two primary bile acids, cholic acid and quinodeoxycholic acid, are synthesized in the hepatocytes of the liver from cholesterol. In this process, the hydrophobic cholesterol is converted into hydrophilic primary bile acids. This entire process of bile acid biosynthesis occurs through a tightly regulated enzymatic cascade within the hepatocytes involving about 14 different enzymes. The two main pathways are the classic or the neutral pathway and the alternative or the acidic pathway. Though the classic pathway is found to be quantitatively more important, it remains dormant in the neonatal period and during infancy, and it is the alternate pathway which is responsible for production of bulk of the bile acids during the neonatal period and during infancy. Therefore, any alteration in the alternate pathway will lead to progressive cholestasis. This bile acid synthesis defects can be divided into two categories, primary and secondary. Primary bile acid synthesis defects are mainly related to deficiency of enzymes which are involved in the process of bile acid biosynthesis. So far, up till 9 types of primary defects have been identified, of which type 1 is the most common. The child in question here had a type 3 defect, which is the deficiency of the enzyme oxysterol 7-alpha hydroxylase. Secondary defects are mainly related to the defect in the transport of bile acids like progressive familial intrahepatic cholestasis and peroxisomal disorders such as Zellweger syndrome. Coming specifically to the type 3 defect which the child had, it is autosomal recessive in inheritance with an incidence of less than 1 in 1 million. The etiology, as described earlier, is a mutation in the CYP7B1 gene located on the long arm of chromosome 8, which expresses the enzyme oxysterol 7-alpha hydroxylase. This enzyme is involved in the acidic pathway and converts the 3-beta monohydroxycholestinoic acids into primary bile acids. The deficiency of this microsomal enzyme leads to the accumulation of all the unsaturated bile acids, which are highly hepatotoxic in nature and can lead to progressive cholestasis. Coming to the diagnosis of these disorders, a high index of suspicion should be there when there is liver function tests are showing cholestasis, that is conjugated hyperbilirubinemia with a normal GGT levels. The recommended screening methods for these disorders is mass spectrometry, which can detect excess amounts of these atypical bile acids either in urine or serum samples because of the enzyme deficiency. However, the main obstacle in diagnosing is the limited availability of this particular mass spectrometry, and the more specific mode of diagnosis is molecular techniques such as exome sequencing, which identify the specific mutations in the genes encoding for these enzymes.
Doctor, exceeding your time.
Coming to the management, in most of the bile acid synthesis defects, supplementation of the primary bile acid replacement has been considered as an effective therapy. However, like we've discussed earlier, there is limited experience with particularly the type 3 defect, and it has shown to have a relatively poor prognosis. Only 1 of the 6 children responded to primary bile acid supplementation. With the presence of the supplemented cholic acid, there was very little change in the concentration of the monohydroxy acids, indicating that this cholic acid was not effective in downregulating the bile acid biosynthesis pathway by feedback inhibition. Coming to the management, like in all metabolic liver diseases, liver transplant is an established therapeutic option. However, there is also a suspicion that a first-degree related donor who can be a potential heterozygous carrier can cause a recurrence. But it has been proven beyond doubt in this particular and other inherited metabolic diseases that it doesn't have any negative impact on the recipients. In our case, the autosomal recessive trait donor graft from the mother was successfully transplanted. The learning point I'd like to put forward is that bile acid biosynthesis defects should be considered as a differential diagnosis when the child has progressive cholestasis with normal GGT levels. For early diagnosis, urine and serum mass spectrometry along with genetic analysis must be performed. And in case of a proven type 3 defect with rapid progression to liver failure, early liver transplant can give the child a new lease of life. Thank you.
Or any questions? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
So this part of presentation is for postgraduates who has to understand that we have to keep the time, be crisp and clear, and we have to make sure that what is the aim of the presentation and what are we telling to the audience. So we all consider all these aspects, and we are here to select two presentations, and everyone who has presented has done it well, but we have to select two, and the first one goes to the teamwork, a case of impacted basket by Dr. Rohan. I request Professor Jeevan Kumar to give Dr. Rohan. The second prize goes to an interesting case of hepatosplenomegaly by Dr. Ishwar from MMC. Professor Shanti Vijayaraghavan. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for patience.
Thanks, that's an interesting session, but I think all the speakers exceeded the time limit. Please speak within the time limit, that is 15 minutes only. So again, I welcome you all for this month's CME. So we have a new member, Dr. J.K. Jamil. He's a surgical gastroenterology from Apollo Hospitals. And I request all the members, please visit our website. All the previous month's recordings is available month-wise. And see the website and give your feedback. And I think Dr. Jayanti and team is negotiating for a group study across Tamil Nadu. We are suggesting three studies. One is from CMC, prevalence of toxohepatitis in Tamil Nadu, and two studies on cirrhosis. One is in midodrine plus albumin plus in refractory ascites and teleperazine and furosemide. Initially, we thought of having an ethics committee for the society, and that is practically it is not very applicable because we have to form a team and spend money for each meetings, because initially we are starting. What I suggest was, what I heard from our ethics committees, whoever lead the studies can have the clearance from their respective ethics committee. Like if EPEN study means they get a clearance from CMC, that clearance can hold for other institutes. They gave the clearance certificate to the other institute, it will hold good. And we should have a meeting, I think, for this. Maybe we'll arrange for some time next month. And as we requested, well, Hepatitis Day was equally participated by both the government and private hospitals. I congratulate all the teaching institutes. And as we suggested, there are 13 members we contributed to the activities, and we compiled the work and sent it to both WGO and WELL Hepatitis Alliance and got the certificates. And I request the pertinence to give the certificates to the members. Professor Jayanti. Dr. Chandan Kumar. Dr. Aravind and team. And myself. And if you missed out any names, I think they also gave some empty certificates also, so we can fill it up and give. So everything is, we are in serious mood. That is, an Indian economy is going down. Any idea why it is going down? Any idea? Karthik? We have so many indices like Sensex and BSE indices. What is MUI? Today also there's an article in Hindu. This is called Men's Underwear Index. So what is it means that if economy is going down means the people, men particularly, they don't buy undergarments. So the last 4 years, there is undergarment indexes keep on going down. It means that Indian economy is going down. So to improve the Indian economy, please buy undergarments. No, sir, they're only for men. This is a follow-up of last month's CPC. We have an interesting case of Castleman's disease. This girl has turned up for last week, and her LFT is normalized, and we removed the bilirubin stent. The IgG4 reduced from 1,200 to 140, and we repeated the PET CT also. And there is the head of the pancreatic lesion is totally disappeared, and all the lymph nodes are vanished, even the pelvic nodes, and the PET CT is complete metabolic response. So we gave the third dose of rituximab today, and she's in very good follow-up. And we are planning to send the case report to the Rare Case Diseases Association so that they can use the case report for their literature. And next month we will meet in Kanyamuri for the midterm ISG, that is on September 28th and 29th. Following that October, we'll have a joint meeting with ISPG GAN, that is Indian Society of Pediatric Gastroenterology and Hepatology Association. They have their annual conference here, and they tie up with the AAG, and they are having a CME on pancreas on October 18th on Friday. And coming to today's topic, and I think these three specialists is involved in certain diseases of the GIT. One is a GI bleed, other is a biliary intervention, the third is a pancreatic intervention. I thought GI bleed is the most common emergency we come across, and I know it is a broad spectrum to cover the what is the beginning, middle, end, that is a proximal small bowel and distal. And we thought involving the three specialists, Sudipto from CMC, and Ravi Kumar, who is one of the finest interventional radiologists in Chennai, and Dr. Jaswant. I know the GI bleed center was in a set up way back in 2000 in Stanley Medical College, and Jaswant is an ideal person to talk on the GA bleed. And I call upon the chairpersons, Dr. Murali and Dr. Nagnath Babu, Dr. Hariharan and Dr. Karthik A.N. to conduct over the proceedings. Thank you.
I thank Dr. Upal Das for giving us the opportunity to chair a very interesting topic, the GA bleed, the beginning, middle, and the end. As everybody is aware, there are two important clinical situations, maybe three also, in GA practice. That is where the involvement of GA endoscopist, surgeon, and interventional radiologist play a crucial role in the combined approach in managing the disease. One among them is GA bleed. The second may be acute pancreatitis and complications. Now, I invite the speakers. Now, first to talk is the endoscopist, Dr. Sudipto Dar Chowdhury from CMC Vellore.
Good evening, everybody. At the very outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Upal Das and the entire TNISG for giving me this opportunity. So I'm talking on the first aspect of gastrointestinal bleeding, the role of endoscopists. Now, it's supposed to be a trialogue, and this case highlights what happens when it is a monologue. So I'll just show you. This is a 71-year-old gentleman who came to us with weakness and fatigue for 3 months. Since 1 month, he had been having black tarry stools. He was evaluated at his native place and found to have a low hemoglobin. He had received 2 units of transfusion there. When he came to us, what we saw was that, is there a pointer here? This one? Okay. When you came here, we did an upper GI scope and a lower GI scope also. And the lower GI scope had only specks of red spots here, which suggested the bleeding was coming from somewhere higher up. So we went ahead and did a CT also, and CT showed nothing except for a thickening of the duodenum. Beyond it, we couldn't see anything. So this is one case where I thought that we should go ahead with capsule, and I repent because we should have given him a tablet instead of a capsule, because this is what the capsule showed. Full of hookworms, and hookworms which were excreting blood. So instead of spending a 12 rupees almondazole, the gentleman spent 40,000 to diagnose this. So that's what happens when sometimes it's a monologue and you're only thinking in the purely in a GI sense. So GI bleed, as Dr. Obal said, is the most common emergencies and it can be anywhere. And for the postgraduates, basically the evaluation goals are very standard: assess the hemodynamic stability, resuscitate, and do the diagnostic identification of source. Now, how do you identify the degree of blood loss? This is a very simple score. This is again aimed at the postgraduates attending this meeting. As to if there is resting tachycardia, we are dealing with mild to moderate hypovolemia. If there's orthostatic hypotension, the blood loss is at least 15%. And if there is supine hypotension, then the blood loss is to the tune of at least 40%. It's a very simple rule of thumb to remember when you're dealing with a patient with GI bleed in the emergency settings. And again, aimed at postgraduates, so it starts with monitoring, airway, resuscitate, give IV fluids if there's hypotension, pump in crystalloids. If there's blood transfusion requirements, if the hemoglobin is less than 9, you give it in high-risk patients, and hemoglobin less than 7. I'll come to it later on. All patients, we put them on PPIs almost twice daily, and if you're suspecting it to be varicella origin, so must turn in analogs and antibiotics. Well, now, the one thing when we were students, at least till 2006-07, we were putting in NG tubes. And later on, we had this one out of vogue. So is there a role of NG tubes? Again, for the postgraduates, basically, it does not show any difference in the mortality, length of hospital stay, surgery, or transfusion requirements when they put in the NG tubes. In a randomized control setting, where the primary outcome was to predict the presence of a high-risk lesion, they did not find any difference. And predicted culprit lesions were identified in both the arms. And in fact, with the placement of the tubes, the patients usually complained of pain, nasal bleeding, or even had a failed placement in 34% of the cases. So obviously, it does not make a difference, and we've stopped putting in NG tubes. Now, what about transfusion strategies? This is, for the poor guys, remember that this is a very interesting study which came out in NEJM in 2013 using a model of less than 7 and less than 9. So they divided these two groups into restrictive and liberal. Exclusions included the following. When they looked at this strategy, restrictive strategy had a better outcome as compared to liberal strategy. And this holds true for all forms of thing, whether you're looking at cirrhosis, childbirth, A, B. In childbirth, C, it really did not make a difference, but whether it's a varicelle or a peptic ulcer bleed either also, it was always in favor of restrictive strategy. That is, we do not need to transfuse until the hemoglobin is less than 7. Okay, so now, skipping this. Now, the endoscopy's armamentarium over the last few years has been going on incrementally increasing. We started off clips, now we have the Ovesco, a very good electrocautery device. Hemospray, this is, of course, what is available. This is hopefully we'll get it in a few months' time. The argon plasma coagulation, the cetrol or sodium tetradical sulfate for sclerosing, the bands, cyanoacrylate glue. The therapeutic armamentarium of the endoscopist has been increasing over time. And as a result, most of the times we are able to manage like a duodenal ulcer bleeding, which is bleeding actively. In many previous times, we would have had to refer such patients for surgery. But with the available of good clips, you can end up with clipping these things very effectively and control hemostasis. Similarly, for varicelle banding, even if there's active bleeding, with the bands, we are able to control most of this. So this is like in another case of a gastric varicelle bleeding. This, of course, came as a surprise to me. Patient was referred for an EUS examination of the bile duct and in a patient with a post-EVL setting. And while doing the EUS, I noticed bleeding. And that's when we saw this spurta coming in from the gastric. But this also can be effectively treated by just by injection of cyanoacrylate glue. So many a times, endoscopists are able to manage most settings of GI bleed. Like you have a gastric enteral vascular ectasia, use of argon plasma coagulation is a very effective mode of controlling bleeding from this microbleeds that happen in these circumstances. Now, even when you have a Dieler-Voigt lesion in the D1, a clip does the trick here. And of course, now with the availability of the hemospray, a lot of things have changed. Even when you are dealing with a large proliferative tumor in the stomach, which is bleeding in previous days, we were struggling with this things, and sometimes we had to send it to the radiotherapist to give a hemostatic radiation therapy. But with the hemospray now, this has become a very effective modality of treatment to control bleeding. So the problems happen now. We are getting more complicated cases. When you have a large gastric varix, how do you deal with it? So this is a gastric varix where you know that if you put in a 0.5 ml of cyanoacrylate glue to 1 ml, it's not going to even touch it. You need larger volumes. So what do we do? So here comes the role of EUS, and that's when we can put in this Nestor coils into this, so if you just keep an eye on the pointer here, you can see the, with the help of the EUS, we can deploy coils within the varices. And these coils have these filaments on the surface of it, after which when you inject glue, this filaments attach the glue and it acts as a scaffold, preventing the migration of the glue and preventing pulmonary embolism. So US-guided coiling is now in vogue now, and it's been done since 2007, and off late more and more cases are being reported. Just a review of literature of it being done. Initially, most of the cases were only with cyanoacrylate glue and lipid oil, but off late, most people prefer to use a cyanoacrylate glue along with coiling, and the success rates are almost to the tune of 100%, and post-procedural complication rates are 7%. Despite this, having done this, if you don't choose a coil of the right size, you can see the coil embolize right in front of you. So the coils have to be chosen very carefully of the right size, of the size of the varix. And until you don't have a coil of that size, if you do it, you can see the coil relatively moving like a spin of a, like a top spinning and then flushing right in front of you. So that's one of the scary part. So I'll show you another one such case. This is a 46-year-old gentleman who came to us with hematemesis and melena, had an acute pancreatitis 2 months ago. At admission, he had tachycardia. Upper GI scopy showed some patchy elevated erythematous duodenal folds. Mucosa. So you can see we did a CT, we did not find a source of bleeding, but we saw a necrotic area very close to the duodenum. So we did, we proceeded with examination of this. Initially, this is a merged video of an upper GI scopy and a EUS, you'll see at the same time. So the upper GI scopy, you can see this irregular area here, and from this, something's coming out. So the necrotic material eroded through the duodenal wall, made a hole, and through it, blood and mucopus was coming in. So we switched on to the EUS, and at EUS, what we saw was that there was an aneurysm here. A very small aneurysm, but that in the presence of a bleeding was significant. So we went ahead and injected thrombin into this aneurysm under EUS guidance. So with a 19-gauge needle, this 2 ml of thrombin, you put on, switch on the Doppler, and you can see gradually a thrombus forming here. And the flow decreases. So US-guided treatment for pseudoaneurysms of late has been coming in. The initial report from India came from Praveer Rai in 2014. And the material he used was thrombin. That was his first case. But recently in 2018, he had published some 6 cases where he used a combination of coil and glue. And the clinical success has been almost 100% with no adverse effects. So this is one area, a space to watch out for. Well, we are coming into pseudoaneurysms too. Now coming into another such case where this is where we cannot, probably we fail, and that's when the dialogues come in. This is a patient with recurrent GI bleed, had a glue injection done for an IGV-1, multiple attempts at glue injection, again presented with upper GI bleed. So what we did find was that there was this large varix which has this glue cast within, and really we couldn't find a space for injection. It appeared hard, but the patient continued to bleed. So I'll just, I don't know whether it'll move effectively, yeah. So we did a CT, yeah. So this is the varix, and if you follow it down, you can see a very nice collateral which is leading onto the renal veins. So having seen this, we asked our, interventional radiology. So we had those consultation with surgeons and the interventional radiologists. Now the surgeons usually do not prefer to do an emergency shunt because the data has been there from time immemorial that emergency shunts have a high in-hospital mortality rates. And now the interventional radiologists really are able to come up with very good effective therapies for these things. So I'll just show you, this is BRTO being done, an occlusion of the varix, of the collateral, sorry, and then the filling up the varix with lipoidal and contrast, and gradually closing of all the collaterals, and then they close this thing. So this is where the dialogue really works. So again, coming to another such case where there was a patient present with hematemesis and melena, and at endoscopy, what we did see was a huge spurter. You can have an eye here that the spurter here is really big. We tried to go close it with the clips, but this was not effective. So virtually, the patient was wheeled out from the scopy room straight to the DSC suite. The advantage we had was we had the clips in place. That acts as a marker for the intervention radiologist to know where he should target his vessel. So you can see this gush of contrast that happened when they did this contrast study here. So and this was effectively embolized by the interventional radiology team. I'm not going into angioembolization. I'm very sure the radiologists will talk about it, but the technical success is pretty good when they deal with it, and almost to the tune of 85% to 90%. Coming back to another such case, where this patient comes with intermittent black tardy stools requiring transfusion, low hemoglobin and admission was transfused, upper GI scopy being normal, lower GI scopy showed only altered blood in the colon and ileum. CT angiography was normal. For the learning of the postgraduate, CT angiography is a good test. Now, if you look at the comparisons with other arms, like a conventional angiography or surgery, sensitivity is 81%. So CT angiography has a very good sensitivity. However, the specificity is slightly on the poorer side. Even when compared to endoscopy, the sensitivity is 88%, DSA 91%. CT angiography is a good test, and most of our interventional radiology experts ask for a CT angiography prior to doing with a blind DSA procedure. Because they say if they can't see on CT angiography, chances of picking up something on a DS is virtually impossible. So other option that we have when you're dealing with a small bowel bleed is a capsule endoscopy. Now, when you look at the capsule endoscopy for obscure GI bleed, the detection rates are 58.6%, completion rates are 84.4% when in the prospective studies. In retrospective studies, the detection rates were 63 and 82%, but overall it comes to boils down to around 60 and 83%. And capsule is relatively a safe test. The most of the lesions that we detect on capsules are angiodysplasias, inflammatory ulcers, or neoplastic lesions. But of course, angiodysplasias are the maximum we see. So this patient, we did a capsule endoscopy. The small bowel transit time was around 2 hours 17 minutes. But all we could see was blood inside the small bowel, which was not really helpful. So now the next option is to proceed with a double balloon enteroscopy. Now the double balloon enteroscopy actually does not have a very good sensitivity. It detects lesions almost to the tune of 60 to 75% of the patients. However, and the correlation between double balloon enteroscopy and capsule endoscopy is only around 66%. Complications are not much, but obviously if you do a capsule endoscopy before double balloon enteroscopy, it's a very good strategy because probably you will be able to detect more lesions. So one thing that capsule helps us is determining the root of the enteroscopy, whether you do an antegrade or a retrograde approach. So if you look at these two studies, this is a very interesting study. If you divide the time between the pylorus and the cecum into three parts, the first two-thirds, that is within 60% of it, if it's seen, if the lesion comes within 0.6, then the base of the cutoff keeping, the accuracy of selecting the insertion route becomes almost like 100%. So if you divide it into three parts, and if you see any lesion within the first two-thirds, we do an antegrade approach. If you see in the later one-third, you do a retrograde approach. Chances of picking up lesion almost to the tune of 100%. The first study, of course, there was done with an orosecal transit time from the ingestion to thing, and that sensitivity was around, the diagnostic was 75%, positive priority value was 94%. But for our center, we stick to this protocol. So we did a double balloon enteroscopy, and we went in both antegrade and retrograde. The antegrade at 250, beyond it, it did not go. Retrograde only could be inserted up to 150. Retrograde, we do it without general anesthesia. Patient did not tolerate. We had to abandon the procedure. So now what are we left with? We talk to surgeons, and this is what we practice, on-table enteroscopy. And at on-table enteroscopy, in a small area of the bowel, we found this red spot which has the squiggly vessels feeding them. They were angiodysplasia. And at on-table endoscopy, what we do is a transillumination test. Fill it up, switch off the light, and you can see this very nice angiodysplasia lighting up. When you're doing an on-table endoscopy, you see a multiple red spots because the surgeons push the scope, thread the scope over the bowel through over the scope. As a result, you lead to multiple injuries in the bowel. So every red spot looks like an angiodysplasia. So if you do a transillumination test, you can actually identify the angiodysplasia. And this is one modality which has really not been explored much, but it's a very helpful modality. And it gives much better information of the small bowel than many other modalities that are available. Now, if you look at most of the studies have been retrospective with very small number of patients, and the specific bleeds have been picked up around 70-58%. But in this case, very small numbers. But the advantage of it is that if you identify a lesion at that point of time, a definitive procedure can be undertaken. So, anyways, I'm not getting into much of details of how to manage GI angiodysplasia. So I'm coming to the last part of it, that is when you have hematochezia. So how do you deal with it? Now, to deal with hematochezia, the bleeding can be from an upper GI source or from a lower GI source. If for the postgraduates, remember, if the patient presents with orthostatic hypotension, patient has myelina along with hematochezia or has hematemesis, or you look at the bun to the creatinine ratio of more than 2, then you're probably dealing with an upper GI source of bleed. Otherwise, if you see clots in the blood, then it's more likely to be a lower GI source. So this is the algorithmic approach we use here. If the patient is hemodynamically stable, we go ahead straight with colonoscopy. If they're positive findings, we treat it. If they're negative on colonoscopy, then, and if it's a self-limited, isolated event, no further evidence of iron deficiency anemia, we just give the patient follow-up. However, if the patient continues to have bleed, then we proceed to upper GI scopy, and normal upper GI scopy, look for a small bowel source. If you find a finding, do a specific therapy. If the patient is hemodynamically unstable, then standard is to resuscitate, get the surgeons and the IR team in picture. Because here we're dealing with something dangerous, may not be amenable to only simple endoscopic therapy. Once stabilized, proceed with an upper GI scopy. Because as I told, if the patient comes in orthostatic hypertension, more likely you're dealing with an upper GI source of bleeding. If there's no normal upper GI scopy, ongoing bleed, do an angio. And if there is normal angio, then only we proceed with a colonoscopy. So this is probably in hematochezia is one arm where actually this trialogue is much more relevant here. So this case, all we did a limited scopy at the bedside, only we could see blood here. We asked the CT angio, did not show any extravasation of contrast, proceeded with a colonoscopy, and at colonoscopy, we saw this. A spurter in the ascending colon, which is just throwing out blood. This patient is currently admitted with us. Still, we just clipped it day before yesterday. He can bleed anytime. Surgeons are in the picture. We know where you have clipped it. That would help the interventional radiology to identify the vessel if they have to block it. And if that fails, we go ahead with surgery. Thank you. So it was a spurter from a specific point. It's more likely a bleeding ulcer which was bleeding from there. We really didn't see what was underlying that.
We don't know the cause.
We don't know the cause. CT angio did not show any vessel feeding that, did not look like a deal of voice. It's just on a point source, we could see one spurt coming out. The day before yesterday only we finished doing this.
What happened to the other case where did the perioperative
area? The patient had a limited area of small bowel involvement. The surgeons went out and resected that area.
You said, of course, we all agree we don't put an NG tube nowadays. But in the case of hepatochezia, when you want to differentiate upper GI, lower GI,
Probably so. Yeah, that sorts out most of your issues.
When there is blood loss, have a hemoconcentration.
Right, sir.
Therefore, estimating the hemoglobin only may not be a proper guide.
Right, sir.
You have to have the PCV.
I agree with it, sir. And most likely, you should do it only when you have adequately resuscitate the person also.
Sudipta, the enteroscope that you showed, no? Peroperative.
Right,
ma'am. In 1982, we had cases, almost 12 cases between 82 and 84, recurrent melena. And Ashok and I, we were the first to, you know, Banerjee was a surgeon, and we did this transillumination, and we took the resected specimen, went to the radiology department, and injected barium.
Wow.
To demonstrate the angiodysplasia.
Wow.
That was the...
Super. Awesome.
So those days, we didn't have enteroscope.
Right,
so we did a...
In fact, even with the enteroscope being there, ma'am, many a times, I feel this gives us much better information than the double balloon
enteroscopy.
Especially
the transillumination.
Yes, ma'am.
This was published in Tropical Gastroenterology, 12 cases.
So what about this intraop? Is it open surgery or laparoscopy?
It's an open surgery. It's a laparoscopy.
This can be done by laparoscopy also.
Oh, right, sir.
So that you can reduce the...
The only thing is that the surgeons in our institute prefer to sheath it, and they need the bowel out. So I think that's what... It's a more of a surgeon's perspective. Really, it's up to them.
But it's possible, feasible.
It's feasible.
May I invite Dr. R. Ravikumar, interventional radiologist, to give his talk.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to thank the organizers and the gastroenterology team to invite the intervention radiologist to be here. With the previous speaker saying about the lot of advancements in the technique, there's definitely a very small role, but a significant role for the intervention radiologist to play. So we come, and he's also shown some examples. So instead of going through the literature stuffs and all that, I'm just going to show you examples like case scenarios where we have been able to help the gastroenterologists, the surgeons, and the patient to help them stop the bleed. One good advantage what I have is the gastroenterology team and the surgeons are so good that I don't worry about the clinical aspect once and the follow-up. Once they say that this is not treatable, they refer it off to us. So I need to worry about the procedure, what I need to use, and how I can stop the bleed. And afterwards, the clinicians take over, which is a plus point plus a negative point. So with my... So my first case is like, it's a 36-year-old male who presented with repeated episodes of upper abdominal colicky pain, spontaneous. No injury, no surgery, nothing has been done. Specifically presents with repeated upper episodes of pain. And following this, he passes black color stools. Twice endoscopy, colonoscopy done, perfectly normal. And then the last time when he presented with colicky pain and hypotension. So this time, because 3 days back only the endoscopist did the endoscopy and colonoscopy, he said there is something else, why don't we do a CT angio? As pointed out by the previous speaker, trust me, CT angio, some people get very upset when I ask for a CT angio. I mean, it had been done once, but repeatedly twice. The importance is CT angio, if it's a dynamic, contrast-enhanced CT angiogram, triple-phase study with an adequate amount of volume of contrast given, with the vein needs to be in the cubital vein. It should be not less than 18G needle size, 4.5 to 5 ml of contrast per second, follow it up with saline. This is how the protocol has to be. If it is properly done, the CT angio can pick up at least at the rate of 0.1 ml per second, whereas a DSA can pick up 1 ml per second. So that's the difference. So invariably, we ask for a CT angio every time nowadays when the patient presents with GI bleed. So this patient had, this is a CT showing the liver, stomach. This is a portal venous phase. You can see dilated biliary radicals. There is hyperdense specs within the CBD. And this is a portal vein which shows extrinsic compression, which is smoothly narrowed. And you can see two abnormal areas there. And you can see this is the lower end of CBD. So this is, we asked Dr. Rochita, I mean, invariably, Dr. Rochita reconstructed this whole thing and he said there's a pseudoneurysm, spontaneous. And we worked up this patient later, and the patient has had vasculitis, basically. So this is one thing where the pseudoneurysm with the vasculitis, we're getting connected to the CBD. That's the cause for the colicky type of abdominal pain. So the gastroenterologist said, you go ahead and embolize this. So you can see this is a catheter angiogram. And now with the advancements in techniques, earlier we were very, I mean, since 98, I've been doing interventions. I knew how the whole intervention radiology evolved. We had big catheters and certain things were inaccessible. But now with the help of microcatheters, we can go up to the vasa recta to embolize. So that's the thing what we can really do without causing much of ischemia or infarct. So what we did was, here you can see that this is narrowed. And we just had to trap the aneurysm. So you can see still the density of the aneurysm, which is Silstein. And you can see we trap it because it should not get retrogradely filled up. So we trap the entire vessel and then we coil it. So this was used only coil. So a lot of equipments are there for embolization. Like we have coils, like you've got the glue, like we can also use the glue. We got other things for embolizations. So this is a 52-year-old male presenting with upper GI bleed and melena. This was, in fact, Dr. K.R. Palaniswamy's patient. So the endoscopy showed some abnormal purple-blue protuberances with surrounding erosions and suspected dulophys lesion. So again, my whole protocol was, I'm not showing the CT angiogram pictures because CT angio did pick up it, and I'm just showing you the, this is not running. The movie file, okay, anyway. I mean, I'll just skip on, go off to the next case, because the dulophoid lesion, this was from the left gastric artery. We had to selectively get into the left gastric artery and embolize it. So, I mean, it would have been nice if I could show the angiographic pictures, but unfortunately it is not. Yeah, that's okay. So this is a case where sometimes when we have less amount of referrals, we create iatrogenically. I'm just joking. It's just that the patient had CA head of pancreas with cholangitis and septicemia. Send for drain, simple drain. And PTBD was done. Patient showed good improvement. Patient shifted from MDCCU to the ward. The fifth day patient they left, acute colicky pain with hypotension. So everybody knows what is happening. So you can see that this is a PTBD drain, all the way internal external drain. And invariably this happens when the patient has cholangitis. You know, like we have to be very careful in manipulating our wires. This is for us basically. So we have created a pseudoneurysm in the area where we have tracked the whole catheter. So you can see the catheter, you can see the pseudoneurysm. I mean, we have got opportunities to block it. So we successfully blocked it and embolized it. Here we had to use a glue cast and we had to use a coil, basically. So this is iatrogenically induced pseudoneurysm. So this is again a 52-year-old male alcoholic with acute on chronic pancreatitis, hemoglobin 5.2, hypotension. Of course, the previous speaker also says pseudoneurysms, they are going to, there's a good role. And you can see that the SMA branch, you can see an abnormal blush, the same abnormal blush is seen here. Again, I'm seeing this is one of the most peripheral branches from the SMA. We can access these kind of peripheral branches too, and we can selectively embolize this. One of the risks, what happens is ischemia. That is what we are worried about. As far as possible, try to be specifically inside the blood vessel. Try to inject the minimal amount of glue or the coil what you use and back off. So you can always read it. Most of the time, it is successful. I'll give you a presentation also where we have seen the number of cases. This is a 39-year-old male. This is Dr. Hariharan's patient, long time back. Abdominal cox, patient irregular treatment, presence with hematochezia. I mean, very little amount of literature is available with tuberculous ulcers causing bleed. This is one such case. We recently had another one, so two cases are there. You can see such an amount of extravasation of contrast. Now, why we need a CT angio is my procedure time. Trust me, if I have a CT angio picture like this, the procedure time takes only 30 minutes for me to complete it because I need not keep searching, get into the SMA, get into the vessel deeply, and just coil it off. So it saves a lot of intra-procedural time. And this is how we did it. You can see the extravasation, coil it back off. And this is, I've shown you about the small bowel bleed. So this is upper, middle, and lower. So I'm just covering off the middle part. So this is a 27-year-old software engineer, operated for PILES. This is one of the first early few cases when I started my intervention procedures here in Chennai. Patient discharged after 24 hours, comes back to the emergency department with acute onset lower GI bleed. So resuturing done, packed with gauze. Patient's turned back. 10 days later, pack removed, spurting of blood from the suture site. Whenever you have a spurting of blood after any injury, that means it's arterial, 100%, if it's non-variceal. Okay, so this is how it was. So we did, that time we had only the 8-slice or a 16-slice CT. I don't remember, CT angio did not pick up this problem of bleeding. So, but then the surgeon was very aggressive and he said, no, you have to go and do the angiogram. So this is an inferior mesenteric angiogram. You don't see any extravasation at all. Perfectly normal. But if you see in this picture carefully, this small vessel which is there, showing like pseudo bulb sign. So I said, let us go in and take more selective pictures. You can see this. This is like a light bulb sign. No vessel which is going terminally has to go smaller and smaller. It cannot become suddenly bigger. Even if you don't see an active bleed, if you see this line, then this is, because usually as a radiologist, we look for active extravasation. I think any blind man can say that there's a bleed there. But you should look for all the subtle signs. So invariably, that's why wherever the patient has got a bleed, when the CT angio is done, I go all over the place to see where the CT angio is done, see the CT angio myself, because there's a little bit of difference what the routine radiologist says, and not to say anything about them, but I like to see it myself. So this really helped me out, because once you go so super selective, inject, see my catheter tip is here, you can see this is actively extravasating. And just one coil and embolizes off. So this was post-pile surgery. So this is all about non-variceal bleed. Variceal bleed also, we do have some role to play. And this is BRTO, which has already been explained by a previous speaker. So I'm not going to go into much of the details. This is for isolated gastric varices. BRTO is a fantastic procedure. You can go ahead and do it. And this is how the hemodynamics of it works. The left adrenal vein, and you can see all these veins finally drain up back into the IVC and then get into the IVC. So what we do is, we get into the left adrenal vein, occluded with the balloon, and then we inject the same cetrol combination to see how we can occlude the gastric varices. So there are plug assisted, there are coil assisted, and there's so many various combinations techniques. It's a very wonderful procedure. And the important thing is it doesn't cause encephalopathy, as how we cause in TIPS. 30% of people with TIPS can have encephalopathy. That doesn't happen here. So this is one of the first very few patients which was referred by Dr. Ravi for gastro when he was with us. So this you can see the isolated gastric varices. And this is how we embolized. So you can see the balloon here. We embolized the entire gastric varices post-embolization, post-procedure. I invariably asked him to do a CT to see, because it was unbelievable. This kind of thing totally disappearing within, you know, like 3 weeks. So this is how the whole gastric varices can be. TIPS, of course, yes, I think everybody knows this is how we go about, and nobody waits for any. We go transjugular, get rid of the hepatic vein, and then balloon dilate the tract. The tract now need not be, again, earlier it was blind. Now we use ultrasound guided to puncture the portal vein, and then we place a stent, and we make sure that the pressure, pre and post, we need to measure the pressures, portal pressures, make sure that it's always less than 12, so that the chance of bleeding becomes less. So this we presented in Korea, where one of the postgraduate students, it was a single center study, and it was done in all the patients from Apollo Hospital, where we prospectively had 112 patients with endoscopic evidence of acute non-variceal GI bleeds. And of course, you see 64, 163, 20. We had the luxury of having 64 and 320. And of course, 162. And it decreases if the CT angio without any iatrogenic procedure like a polypectomy, or like we have done a PTBD
or an ERCP papillotomy, etc. Then if CT angio does not show a bleed, I do not touch the patient at all. If there is an iatrogenic history, then you still go ahead, because after papillotomy, you would always put a stent. So the stent will not be able to show the extravasation will have a and polypectomy. These are few indications where I bypass the CT angio. Otherwise, CT angio is the gold modality of choice. And 84 patients showed positive CT imaging findings. And 84 patients underwent therapeutic embolization using either permanent or temporary embolic agents. 28 patients did not show any CT angio. 21 patients were managed conservatively, and the remaining 7 patients underwent embolization in spite CT angio not showing because there was some endoscopic procedure done. So everything had super selective, and this was well appreciated. This was the various causes. I'm not going to go into the various cause, the various etiological factors, right from Dulafoy, pseudoneurysms, anatomical sites. We can cover up any anatomical site of the upper, lower, middle GI bleeds. And these are the arteries where we can enter into any artery possible within available techniques. And these are the various particles that we can use. And of course, this is Mohammad Zubair who presented it. Of course, Pritham Chatterjee always helps me out with all my cases. And thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi. I'm very happy that you highlighted the role of CT angiogram. And one thing what we face in an institutional practice is people are a little hesitant to repeat the CTs. And one message for all the postgraduates and whoever is referring, you ask for a CT angio protocol to pick up a bleed. What happens otherwise in a non-specialized CT, many people use positive contrast, where it totally, you know, you don't see the lumen at all. You have to see the mucosa. And I think a well-performed CT angio with a good dose of contrast and the protocol what Dr. Ravi explained, invariably, at least 85 to 90% of the times, we will be able to kind of at least localize the area where the interventional radiologist has to concentrate. So I think CT angio is mandatory. And do not ask for your own institutional CT angio, even if he has multiple CTs done outside.
See, I mean, if you have, I mean, the nucleus scan, there is no strict thing. If a nucleus scan can pick up a GI bleed, the CT angio will definitely pick up. The importance where it will come is it, the nucleus scan will be able to say what time they have done the, they were able to pick up the extravasation of contrast. If it is within the first few hours, say within the first 1 to 2 hours, it is most likely arterial. And if it is going to be, because they do the delayed scans for the next more than 24 hours. So if it is going to be happening delayed, and then you see the transit, it can be venous. Venous, again, as an interventionist, we don't have any role to play, not much role to play. But the CT angio can miss this venous phase. That is where the problem, because we are you must understand in a CT, we are capturing at one phase, that is at one time. Just the CT scan is over, and then within 13 seconds, the whole CT is over. So if you miss that particular phase, you can miss the entire bleed at all. That's why the repeated CTs. So that's why the arterial phase, it is usually very difficult to miss a lesion. So, and again, the anatomy. If you need to know the anatomy, I think CT angio is better. But now they've got come out with spec CT, a combination of things which are there. But I don't think so. Not many institutions do have it. But if you have a CT which can give you, because sometimes it can show only an extravasation on nuclear scanning, but for all that we know, there may be a tumor which is there. But a CT angio, if it is there, it can really give you the tumor which is present, what is the enhancement, so you avoid certain things. So I think I would rather keep nuclear medicine scan a little bit away only for selective cases, not for all, like how it was done earlier.
I mean, obvious lower GI bleed or GI bleed, but still CT angio doesn't pick up, meaning is probably it could be venous. How common you have seen venous bleed? And what is the answer for it?
I really don't know, sir.
How common you have encountered, at least that you can say?
I mean, lower GI bleed, we have not encountered much of a venous ooze, but upper GI bleeds, yes, we have done a couple of procedures targeting the vein percutaneously or whatever, but we do have faced. But the CT angio has not picked up so far a venous type of a ooze because it is not at the rate of 0.1 to 0.5 ml per second. If it is actively oozing, yes, it can, but otherwise it doesn't pick up, sir.
Okay. Ravi, in a certain situation, we are even misguided by radionucleotide scan. It shows the bleeding is in the terminal ileal part,
yes, sir,
but we found it to be a proximal small bubble.
Yes, sir.
How that mistakes happen and how to...
Sir, again, that's the problem, sir, because they are doing it over 24 hours and every time they come after 3 hours, 4 hours.
Oh.
Suppose if the leak has happened between the first hour where they finish scanning and the patient comes down for the next scan at 3 hours, in between they will see the whole contrast going down and lodging into the terminal ileum because it goes into the lumen. And then they'll say there's a, which is a finding of leak there. So most probably the bleed will be in the small bowel, but actually it may not be. That's why I'm saying the radionuclide scanning now, I think, had to be reserved only for some cases, not for all.
Thank you. Any other questions? That is well known. When only when there's an active bleed, we can pick up.
There won't be one investigation of choice in those kind of things, like how you have to combine with your capsule endoscopy, enteroscopy, so many things. If CT angio is normal, then I think the other things have to be brought into the picture now.
Yeah.
I think that's how I think we should be, because you've got whole armamentary of gadgets to find out what is the problem now. Yes, sir. Sir, one thing which is definitely saying, which is where I don't touch the cases, where if there is a tumoral bleed, if I see a tumor which is showing enhancement in the bleed, I don't touch it at all. I just say refer it off to the surgeon. And if I don't see a tumor, or if I see where there's a, like how what cases I've shown, then we go ahead and we prefer to do it. But invariably in our team, the gastroenterologist, the surgeon, and the interventionist is always there. So depending on the patient also. Suppose an angiodysplasia, multiple segments of angiodysplasia.
Like any major vessel bleed, like a splenic artery, hepatic artery, major trunk is bleeding. Ligonda, for example, pseudoaneurysm of the
splenic artery.
Or hepatic artery in the trunk. Is it possible for you to? Or you will say?
We have got methods to come out of it. We got covered stents and we can really tide over it, sir, actually. So, if you ask me when I'm doing it, so I don't think so. I would prefer to do the case as much as possible. Unless the splenic vein is so tortuous, where I'm not able to reach. And artery, that's all. So, splenic artery sometimes becomes very tortuous, especially in hyperspermidism, we get this. So, where I cannot reach it, then I cannot put a covered stent. So, that's the time when we refer it off to the surgeons. But now we've got percutaneous access where we can inject thrombin. I mean, there's a lot of things. I didn't show all those cases, sir. But if it's a tumor, definitely I don't touch those patients, sir. I'll just say left it off the patient. Yes, sir.
But how early do strictures or anything develop? It may be one is ischemia, but do they develop late strictures? Do we come across that? Because there was one patient who was probably,
yes,
embolized for his some superior rectal artery somewhere in Kenya or somewhere. Many years down the line, he developed a stricture. So how often does this happen and what time frame does it happen?
In the whole series, the two patients had re-blood and they had to undergo repeat embolization surgery. Two patients had bowel ischemia. So bowel ischemia is one thing which even we are dreaded about. So, I mean, this was, both the patients had glue injection. Bowel ischemia can happen as an acute phenomenon. You keep checking their lactates. And the strictures, I think one case of stricture we have also faced. But I don't know what is the pathophysiologic mechanism, but as far as I think it's the most of ischemic stricture. But it's relatively very less when compared to the acute bowel ischemia which can happen post-embolization. It is a very important complication which the clinician has to know that this can happen with embolizations. Definitely, yes. So that's why we choose the choice of the embolization material, what we need to do. If you're highly super selective, inject one drop of glue and back off. If you're very proximal, we're not able to reach, then we put coil. That's how the whole armamentarium goes. But yes, bowel ischemia can happen. It has happened. And I think we should be careful about that. Sorry, the post-pancreatitis?
Pseudoaneurysm, controlled with intervention. Do they re-bleed or?
So post-pancreatitis, yes. I mean, that is one of the most common cases what we get. Again, in our, I think in our whole series, there were around 12 patients of post-pancreatic pseudoaneurysms, and two had re-blood because when they fill up from other vessels, and in which one of the cases where we had Sham Varadarajalu, where we did endoscopy guided directly glue injection, like how it was shown by the previous speaker. But usually we were able to take care of the thing only if there are multiple feeders, sir. Because then pancreatitis, at one point or that point of time, we can see only one vessel is bleeding, but suddenly they can fill up. That's why the whole idea is to fill the whole aneurysm with the coil or a glue so that it doesn't have any opportunity to get refilled. Once there was a patient when I was doing it in global, I had to take him up for three procedures because every time this is chronic calcific pancreatitis, three different areas of aneurysm. One I will embolize, after 2 weeks he had another aneurysm, he had another aneurysm. It was very one of the rare cases which I've done. But yes, it does happen, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now from non-surgical intervention, we'll move on to surgical intervention. I invite my good friend, Professor Jaswant, to talk about the role of surgeons in the management of bleeds. And Professor Jaswant is from Stanley Medical College, which started the first bleed center in government setup.
So good evening, everybody. My thanks to Dr. Baldas and TNISG for giving me this opportunity. I won't be talking much about surgical options. I will be giving some clue to diagnose. Once you diagnose, the treatment is very easy. The endoscopic or radiological or surgery. First patient. Most of this case, Dr. Kannan is aware. 50-year-old male patient, hematemesis in 8 hours duration. Endoscopy was done outside, diagnosed as carcinoma lower end of esophagus and referred to us. So patient admitted in Stanley and patient had persistent bleeding. So we also did endoscopy. Before that, spalar pulse was 120 per minute and BP was 160 bar 110. Hemoglobin is 8 grams and UGSCOPY showed blood clots, the esophagus with active bleeding. Also diagnosis. So what to do next? Since patient is actively bleeding, we proceed directly with surgery. And we just mobilize the esophagus and finger went straight into the aorta. And patient collapsed on the table. So it was in a case of aortoesophageal fistula because of aortic aneurysm. Here again the clue is BP. Blood pressure 160 or 110, even a massive bleed. We had three more cases like that with high blood pressure. One case again, aortoesophageal fistula, we didn't touch that, patient died. Another two patients with aorto duodenal fistula following repair of the aortic aneurysm. See, the point is whenever you have high BP, suspect. Second case capsule. 26-year-old female, married 8 months back, 6 months history of recurrent hematemesis, about 100 to 200 ml per episode. So repeat UGSCOPY from Trivandrum to Chennai. This was normal or gastritis. We also, in our part, did our endoscopy. We showed gastritis. So what to do? Actually, she's my niece. Because recently married, so we did CT scan, CT chest, it showed lesion in the carina. The bronchoscopy done CMC Vellur, and bronchoscopy excision was done. And biopsy didn't reveal anything actually, whatever it is. Then sent to Mayo Clinic that showed inflammatory pseudotumor containing invaded cells along with myofibroblasts. She's all right. So we get 5 to 10% of cases as hematemesis, actually hemoptysis. The simple thing, ask the patient to cough and see. Patient person like tuberculosis or bronchiectasis, they'll bring out some blood. There the diagnosis ends. And like these young patients can have, we had bronchial adenoma, bronchial carcinoid, this is another rare case, bronchial pseudotumor. This again, you should listen to the clue history. 48-year-old male, history of hematemesis and hematochasia, 1 week duration, plus pain abdomen. Past history of blunt abdomen 40 days back. On examination, pallor, icteric, disoriented, ugoscopy was normal. It's a CT scan that it was taken. You can see that right lower part, I think, close to segment 5-6. Then your liver was seen. This is angio. So done Bernard Institute that time from Stanley, referred to the patient. Consider pseudoaneurysm. They couldn't embolize the pseudoaneurysm. So patient continued to bleed. It was operated, and cholecystostomy and T2 drainage was done. Why it was done, I don't know. And patient continued to bleed through the cholecystostomy and T-tube. And we had to intervene. I had to go for right hepatectomy. Patient became all right. So the diagnostic point is, whenever patient complains significant pain, you always think of hemobilia, hemosuccous pancreaticus, or bleeding from pancreatitis eroding into the duodenum, or eroding into the colon, or into the stomach. No patient with gastric ulcer, duodenal ulcer, varies, will complain bleeding first. I have never seen. If I can diagnose from at home, patient with some complaints, okay, patient has bleeding, signal bleeding followed by hematemesis. Previous to, she also mentioned, doing multiple endoscopy, colonoscopy, had they known this fact, okay, patient complained pain, signal pain. You suspect this straight away, go for CT scan, ultrasound, CT scan, and diagnose. The clinical history is very, very important. The same way, clinical findings also very, very important. You can diagnose so many things, so many. You can localize the site of the brain, come to that later. Same way, one patient, doctor's relative from Nagrovil, they did endoscopy, of course, hematemesis. They saw one ulcer in the stomach. Then they went to Trivandrum, their KIMS is there. They did their diagnosis, gastritis, sandbag. Here again, bleed. They just ask the history. What's the history? It's pain followed by bleeding. It don't just take CT scan. It showed pseudoaneurysm rupturing into the stomach. That was shown as a gastric ulcer, actually. The history is very, very important. Another case, 16-year-old male patient, recurrent episodes of melena, abdominal pain, hematemesis. Again, here, abdominal pain and hematemesis. Diagnosis is obvious. Similar attack 1 year back, treated conservatively. This time, more than 15 units of blood transfused. On exam, afebrile, anemic, not icteric. So the hemophilia patient will be mild icteric. So here it is not icteric. And there is abnormal tenderness, hemoglobin was 6.4 gram percent. So ultrasound cirrhosis, body of pancreas. The CT, the pseudoaneurysm. This also they couldn't embolize. Not they're embolizing, that thing couldn't embolize. Again, angio, so pseudoaneurysm, embolize. man conservatively again readmitted with massive bleed, so went straight away with surgery actually, because embolism failed again. So here the pseudoaneurysm bleeding in the body of the pancreas. We went for central pancreatectomy. Distal posterior be anastomosed with the jejunum. So we are getting control all around, fearing massive bleed, but that was not so. These are during our initial periods. So we are very careful. So I'm skipping the video. Of course, we excised that and did the central pancreatectomy and anastomosed jejunum to the distal pancreas. The patient had chronic pancreatitis also, removed the stones also. It comes 10. A 30-year-old female patient, acute cholecystitis, lab cholecystectomy performed elsewhere for empyema gallbladder. Post of day 7, readmitted for fever and pain abdomen. So it showed coated lobe liver abscess and drained around 1 liter of seroprone fluid and discharge. Readmitted again with hematemesis and melina. On examination, with febrile tachycardia, hypotensive and hemoglobin 6 grams per deciliter. Also showed pale gassy mucosa, duodenum not entered. The CT picture. Again, following cholecystectomy, pseudoaneurysm. In this patient, we straight away went for surgery because already patient had withdrawn 1 liter of fluid, infected thing. So we want to drain that also. We didn't attempt this one, angioembolization. We repaired the hepatic artery and put a T-tube in the CBD and came out. Patient became all right. It's a 40-year-old male patient, hematomas and melina of 2 days duration. Gastric scope normal up to second part of duodenum. And contrast and CT showed extravasation in the duodenum. So what to do next? So as a surgeon, we proceed again with surgery. So proceed with surgery, since OGD showed up to second part normal, duodenotomy was done in the third part of duodenum. So we could not see any lesion, what to do. We palpated the rest of the small bowel also, we couldn't feel any nodules, something else. And of course, we are planning intraoperative endoscopy also. We always plan intraoperative endoscopy also in case of missing the lesions. But we insert a finger on either side, we could feel a small nodule on the mesenteric aspect. Based on that, we opened the particulars in the fourth part of duodenum, opened that area and sutured. It was like something like Dieler-Weiss lesion. Small nodule. These are small clinical clues to find out the lesion. You don't see. Palpate gently. This is another 24-year-old male patient. Here also you got to have a clue. Bleeding per rectum into 5 days duration. Fear 2 weeks back, lasting for 5 days. Next time, patient pallor, febrile, pulse at 110, BP was 100 over 70, hemoglobin was 7.2 gram per deciliter. Endoscopy normal, colonoscopy blood in the colon, persistent bleeding, what to do? Any diagnosis? Not from the colon. Fever is there, no? Yes, that's the clue. Mostly, enteric ulcer bleed, most likely. So almost all enteric ulcer bleed had a previous history of fever. Not necessarily high-grade fever. The high-grade fever, which they will treat aggressively. So C-source or abdomen source normal. We did surgery with laparotomy intraoperative endoscopy. Called bleeding enteric ulcer was found. That area was just segmental resection was done and sutured. This another 19-year-old male patient with melena and tiredness of 2 years duration. On extension, pallor, field edema was there. No soft, no moss found, bubble sense was increased. Ugoscopy and colonoscopy are normal. CCT showed multiple diverticula in the small bubble. Multiple diverticulae. How to go about CT anchu or capsule endoscopy? So anyhow, since patients, this albumin was 1.8 gram actually. So when they got the laparotomy and planned interrupt endoscopy also, it's a finding. The mid segment around 100 centimeters. So strictures and diverticular present outside on the anti-mesenteric side. Madam knows, yeah. So we resect the whole segment, bring it out outside. So since albumin was very low, we didn't anastomose. So biopsy, Crohn's, Crohn's disease. This is a 30-year-old male patient. Here, fever, diarrhea, abdominal distension, bleeding per rectum. Colonoscopy diagnosis, cecal growth. CCT wall thickening, cecal wall thickening with multiple liver secondaries. Any diagnosis, any? If you are previously experienced, you will diagnose. All right. Any other initial periods, no? Anyhow, when we saw there is no liver secondaries, the cecum was edematous, similarity. So we did limited resection only. And this came as amoeboma. What is the diagnosis? Again, same thing. Bleeding, fever, CT diagnosis, colonic growth, liver secondaries. Since we got previous SP diagnosed amoeboma, managed with, amoebic ulcer, amoebiasis, amoeboma. You can manage with Metrogyl, became outright.
Which year, how many years back?
This is around at least some 7 years back. This is from CSA Kalyani Hospital, multi-specialty. This patient went to an entire cancer center, refused surgery because very advanced this one. Then two or three hospitals and came back to again to Kalyani Hospital.
No wonder surgeon is asking for tissue diagnosis.
Yes. This is another 50-year-old person, one very important person. There was a colic pain of 2 days duration and bleeding per rectum 2 days duration. Ultrasound abdomen showed bulky pancreas. Serum amylase was 840 units per liter. Because patient had to, this one filed nomination paper, Rajesh Sabha. So he had to go to Chennai, last date, knife hits. So diagnosed acute pancreatitis, in fact. Colonoscopy showed multiple erythematous patches with bleeding points. Can you correlate bulky pancreas, raised amylase, multiple erythematous patches? The main problem is since patient VAP, nobody examined it thoroughly. Now, what's your diagnosis? Can I tell him, see, severe pain. The pain stopped just spasmodic, antispasmodic. So, one should thoroughly examine the patient, go in the history, should always auscultate the patient, should listen to the music of the GI tract, should love that. Can pinpoint the source of bleeding. If the rectal bleeding has separate bowel sounds will be there, in the right left glia fossa, small bowel separate bowel sounds, even colon separate bowel sounds, enjoy that. So if you lose your sense of clinical diagnosis, artificial intelligence will replace you. Before asking the what test to do, how to diagnose based on history and clinical examination. Yes, you saw, I always carry stethoscope. I love stethoscope. Gastroenterologists need stethoscope more than physicians, the cardiologists, cardiologists, because you have to auscultate heart, you have to auscultate chest, you have to auscultate the abdomen also. Bowel sound and so many things. This is a 60-year-old male patient. Kinasal in purpura. Recurrent bleeding, PR in 6 months, occasional vomiting. Past history of GJ with Vega time for Dion also 25 years back. On aspirin as a prophylactic dose. Colonoscopy normal, UG endoscopy status PGJ with some gastric erosions. Exam paler, hemoglobin 8 grams per deciliter, resting normal, CCT, CT angio normal, continues to bleed. Bleeding per rectum. All this patient is a VAP from Madurai actually, came to Stanley. We'll be visiting many hospitals. So went back to proper history. Patient has sudden urge to pause motion, but patient passes blood only. In between, patient passes normal stools. So obviously, anorectal bleed. So proctoscopy, sigmoidoscopy, normal except for grade 1 hemorrhoids. So, I stayed in the ward for 24 hours telling the patient, when you bleed, tell me. I'll come and examine you. Protoscopy done at the time of bleeding. So dilophyll lesion in the aneurysm between the folds of humeral cushion. So also very, very important how to examine, when to examine, how to ask the history. If you don't, then go back to the history again. Some it might strike us, discuss with your colleague. This patient is post ERCP bleeding, and we did with sphincteroplasty and suture the bleeding point. Just massive bleed, we sutured it. Not running. The same post whipples also. Sometimes we get massive bleed. Patient will be in shock, especially when we do pancreatic gastrostomy. It can bleed from the pancreatic stump actually. We cannot do endoscopy, stomach will be fully filled with blood. So we know in those cases we'll go straight away for surgery. Indicates surgery in portal hypertensive bleed. So when our patient, SILS A patient, recurrent bleed, surgery is one of the good options actually. Why I'm telling this is, from a native place, on rubber tapper, 40 years old. Whenever the bleeder got tantrum, twice he went, glue injection done, and banding also done. He lost some 5 lakhs. He sold his property. He's not going for work also, fearing further bleed. I brought him here, did shunt, he went back, went for the work, doing fine, got married, the 2 children also. The same bachi are yearly. Surgery gives very good results. You have patients with getting married and children getting pregnant also. So appropriate surgery for appropriate people, not one treatment. The same EHPO also. Nowadays, if left portal vein is patent, straight away we can go for Rex and as a prophylactic shunt. With these few points, I finish my lecture. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Jess, for bringing out so many interesting cases. So now the role of surgeons is actually diminishing. We don't have primary role now in most of the bleeding, except, as he said, in subset of cases. Otherwise, our role is only salvage. I would like to share my small experience. 15 years ago, one senior most assistant professor in surgery, he brought his father, who had recurrent attacks of hematochezia. And he was evaluated by all top medical and surgical gastroenterologists in the city by various investigations, endoscopy, colonoscopy, CTs, everything. And still, the patient was used to be resuscitated bed and then become all right, and again de-bleed after some time. So he wanted an opinion from my chief professor, Subramaniam. So he brought the patient to our hospital. And instantly, that was our theater day. So my chief just inquired and went through the reports and he asked whether he is willing to undergo surgery because he was bleeding. So we thought it could be an angiodysplasia. So we just wanted to do a right hemicolectomy, blind right hemicolectomy. So actually, the doctor was very much, I mean, shocked when we said whether he is willing for surgery. But somehow they gave the consent. We prepared the theater itself and shifted. We did a laparotomy. To our surprise, there was a small lesion, the jejunum, which was bleeding. And we just resected, it turned out to be a gist. Very small lesion. And he developed an arrest on the table during the procedure, revived. Subsequently, he was put on ventilator support for a few days and became all right. He was discharged and he lived for almost 5 years. And after that, he developed secondaries and died. So at that those days we didn't have much facilities.
There's no need. If you got auscultated, you got listened to the music.
No, no.
Diagnosed.
So even now, I think when the facilities are not available, not feasible, I think there is a role for surgery. Thank you.
I think.
Bleed, a very heavy bleed. He had no other option and he took the help of others and put a Danicel stent. Patient became all right. He went for surgery in 28th day. So Danicel stent has got a role. Although it's costly, to remove is difficult. I thought at this point I want to share it. Danicel stent, we asked metal stents in bleeding. This is for a liver transplant patient, had a recurrent residual massive bleed. He put a technique of putting is also there. They put on 28th day, even for surgery, liver transplant. So this is a point we have to take it. Danicel stent has a role. Spray has got a role. We had need lot of. Nariya, you should have multiple.
Once we diagnose it, no.
You have a cafetiere approach. Cafetiere approach, not one ET dosa illa. You have to have a cafetiere approach.
Yes.
Respected teachers, friends, on behalf of the ISG Society, we would like to thank all the chapters and speakers. Senior professors, teachers, and friends for having attended, come in large numbers to make this same year a grand success. I would like to thank Sun Sickness for helping us to conduct this meeting. I will thank the hotel management for the ambience. I'm requesting everybody to join us for dinner. Thank you.